time.
Behind the back, an ankle breaker on Chris Paul.
Crossover.
The crossover continues to evolve.
All right, time for the crossover on a Thursday. Sweet 16. Did you sneak down to practice and speed back here?
Yeah. I got a KFC Famous Bowl at the Yum Town.
No, football practice. We're talking about football, man.
Oh, no, I thought we were talking about Creighton basketball. I was just down in Louisville this morning. No, I didn't go to football today. But I see all these videos of Jeff Sims, like,
with no helmet
on, sort of walking around.
Yeah.
I have seen zero videos of him actually throwing a football. All I want to see is him throw one football and see what happens. I've just seen him kind of. Can somebody tweet at me if they've seen a video of Jeff Sims actually physically throwing a football?
I saw him take a snap and go into his drop.
Yeah, same. But saw a lot of that.
Yeah.
That's as close as we got.
Maybe that was intentional.
So if anybody got a video of Jeff Sims actually throwing it, please send it my way. I just want to see. Because first impressions are important. When I saw Tanner Lee throw a football for the first time, I was entranced. I was like, wow. This is the guy. Look at the way it comes out of his arm. Look at the way it comes off his finger.
We were all fooled.
We were. We were bamboozled.
And then there was the game against Northern Illinois.
I will still maintain that he wasn't that bad. Didn't have a lot of help around him from either a coaching or a player standpoint.
The play calling definitely hindered him.
I guess he had some players, obviously. But, yeah.
But he also made some poor decisions.
Made some poor decisions. Missed high a lot.
The pick six against Northern Illinois when you threw it to Ozigbo.
Well, I still remember. Well, that one. Okay, that's a great example, Gary. It went off of Ozigbo's face. Off of his face. What are you supposed to do? Like, that's, that's where you're supposed to throw it.
At his face.
Well, you're supposed to throw it to him.
Maybe throw in his hands.
Well, I guess you could, but
coming out of the backfield.
You would think that, hands, if you're ready to catch it in the chest, they're not far away from the face.
It's a new day, though.
It is a new day.
Yeah.
Well, Scott Frostold's staff still wants to talk about how it's not a new day. Did you see this?
Yeah, I discussed it earlier.
I don't really.
It probably makes sense.
Yeah,
it also shows you what I think. And I said this, and you guys may disagree. I think the personality. So Bo to Mike to Scott, they all different personalities in the transition. I think Matt Rhule and Scott Frost have the same kind of personality.
Scott,
they just have
Matt.
A different skill set.
I agree. No,
so
yeah.
That makes the transition a little bit easier. Where it's not as shocking to the system. Like when guys went from Bo to Mike, they literally, and we say this and people think we're joking, Mike Riley was very, very kind. He was a very, very nice person.
Yeah.
But you went from a fiery individual to a guy that, like, was way too nice and probably should have been more of a Richard at the beginning of his tenure, which probably would have helped in terms of the locker room and guys either sticking around or buying in. So I think that's where the transition is a lot easier for Matt Rhule.
This is a complaint, and I get it. And I think if you frame the question up this way, it's a fair one to ask. I think Scott Frost probably left, if we're talking about the next coach and their position to have success, Scott Frost left it in a better place than Mike Riley did. Is that fair? Now, some of that is what did when he got here.
I will say that Mickey Joseph and the rest of the staff left it in a better place.
All right. Yeah. That's fair, because that could have slid out way out of control.
Because mid-September, it was going downhill.
Yeah. But end of 2022, you got a lot of guys in the roster who are, it's just, they're in a position to feel a little bit better about it. Compared to end of 2017.
This is a good discussion, because I was thinking about this with Shrewsbury leaving Penn State and going to Notre Dame. And Penn State basketball, how do you ever keep somebody if you went all in on Micah Shrewsbury and he's still, Notre Dame was a better gig.
Tough.
Is he did leave it in a better spot.
Oh, absolutely.
So
Pat Chambers left it in a better spot.
like the outrage of Providence fans for Ed Cooley. Didn't Ed Cooley at least leave Providence in a better spot than what he took it over?
Yeah, but that
I know there's a lot of elements going on with, going to a conference rival, but at least he left it in a better spot. Like, look at basketball and the transition of Danny Need to Barry Collier. Did Barry Collier leave it in a better spot than he inherited? Or was it the same?
It was not so great at the end of Danny Nee, obviously.
So go Collier to Doc Sadler. It was okay.
So end of Doc or end of Barry to end of Doc?
Yeah,
Doc is okay.
But Barry to Doc wasn't bad.
Yeah.
He didn't, the timing wasn't great, but it's not like he left and the whole program was in a dumpster.
Yep.
Doc to Tim Miles.
Yeah, basketball is just so weird though, because Tim had to rebuild the whole thing. And did. But it's often like, you know, when new coaches arrive in basketball, they're going to be, especially now, they're going to be dealing with completely different rosters.
And kind of conversations in basketball like end now, but like still Miles to Hoiberg because the portal was not, you know, in full effect.
Yeah, there was nobody on the roster. There's nobody there. They had to bring in all those people and they had to do it in a short amount of time.
It was, you know, did Frank leave it in a good spot for Bill Callahan? Actually, yes.
Yeah, for sure. Now,
it was
was
a drastic,
correct,
schematic change.
Some of it is about what the next coach does when they come in, you know, how are they going to approach that piece of it? You know, and Scott, I think, if you ask them that part of it now, they could have maybe smoothed that a little bit more. Because they talked about it in this story, how the transition was from George O'Leary to them,
yes,
to them. And they're like, that's okay. Like, that's, you know, we can smooth that out. We could be ourselves. This time around is a little bit different, coming from a different guy.
They made football fun at Central Florida. I found it interesting because I remember this because Michael Lewis, who used to be on Tim Miles' staff, would go and play. Is remember the first year when the noon basketball pickup was a big deal and there'd be a lot of other coaches that would come and be involved? Why did that end?
I don't know. People stopped having fun.
Yeah. They did.
They really did.
Like,
it got too serious in a hurry.
Or maybe they took the fun like in-house instead of going to the rec center. They said, you know what? Fun will be on a golden tee. And where we can't invite a lot of people to come play.
Yeah.
But the noon basketball game, Frost talked about that. Like, it's super competitive. It's great. He's out there hooping up. That like went away. And
yeah,
nobody said, hey, do you play basketball anymore?
Well, maybe it's that, I don't know, just, you know, Scott, you had a kid, you had a couple kids during his time in Nebraska, like stayed home a little bit more, not much time to get out and play noon ball. Like, I don't know. I think that all matters, but that did go away. And that was a thing at the beginning. Remember they had videos? I was poring over all those videos when they came up from UCF because they did like a whole docu-series,
yes,
on the team. And it was some great stuff in there. And it was mostly about like, hey, we like to have fun here, you know? And there just wasn't much of that after.
Well, it's a job that can suck the life out of it.
Obviously.
We've seen coach after coach after coach. At least Rule initially looks like he's made things fun.
Yeah.
Like guys generally look like they're having fun, even in winter conditioning, which, you know, does not seem like any part of fun to me.
No.
I have a question here.
All right.
And you can help me here.
Is it about Hoda?
It is not about Hoda. Hoda is back, right?
Oh, yeah. Hoda's back.
Okay.
Yeah.
I am in the quest to do something because I do like my Diet Coke.
And love Diet Coke.
There is no doubt, and I've researched this, and I've asked people that work at McDonald's on why McDonald's fountain soda, doesn't have to be Diet Coke, can be any fountain soda, is the best soda going.
Yeah, no, there is a reason.
Yeah. Because of the nozzles.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Correct.
And the syrup.
But they like filter it in two.
Yes.
They have two ways of filtering it.
But in particular, Diet Coke doesn't taste as good anywhere else except for McDonald's when it comes out of the, you know, out of the fountain.
That's right.
The next best place to get good quality fountain soda.
Ooh, great question. Love that.
Because you guys are
QT with the ice.
See, I think you know what? The ice does make a difference at QT because you have options.
Yeah. Let's say, well, you know, you really only have one option. It's the crushed ice.
True.
There's something about a big see-through cup, though. I love how McDonald's changed their cups too.
Oh, they made them smaller.
The plastic, but they're plastic.
Yes.
Instead of the paper cups. I think there's something to that too. I like drinking out of a see-through plastic cup. McDonald's did this. All the gas stations have had it for a long time. They have the styrofoam cups at the gas station. I don't get them. I don't care if they cost less. It doesn't matter.
Keeps it colder longer.
I don't care. Doesn't matter, Josh.
Okay.
I like the plastic cup with the plastic lid on top of it. I realize it's probably not so great for the environment.
What is your go-to convenience store? Because you come in here with...
Like if I have options, or if you're talking about just on my way...
You know Ravi, who Ravi, I think, dabbles in all the convenience stores in town.
I do. I don't think... I'm a little bit of a, you know...
Whore?
Monogamist in that, yeah. Oh.
Did you say hoarder?
No, he no. didn't say that.
No.
You stopped before you got to the...
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. It's sort of whatever's on the way, but... Like, I'll rarely go out of my way to get something from a convenience store. But if I do, it's probably QT. It's probably QT.
Mailman Todd.
Hey, Mailman Todd.
So here's, you know, if it's a good place in terms of like fountain soda or what they have on the roller is how many construction workers are there?
Yes. Yes.
Like if you're at a convenience store and there's a lot of like construction vehicles that are in the parking lot.
Guys must wearing
be
vests.
Good, yes. Must be a good place. They got good... taps, and they've got good food on the roller.
Cargo pants.
Mailman Todd says come and go. All their fountain are calibrated the same.
I don't go buy a come and go.
I like a come and go. Their food, however, they've taken a... They're on a health kick.
Oh, really?
That's
oh,
not really boy. What I'm looking... I understand that in the marketplace, yes, that differentiates them from other convenience stores, and that's important, but that's not why I'm eating at a convenience
come
store.
Come and go is too Iowan for me. I look at come and go, I think Iowa.
So Casey's would be the same?
No, Casey's...
Is Iowa.
Casey's, for whatever reason, doesn't give off that vibe for me.
Okay.
It's a vibe thing.
Sure. No, I understand.
I don't know where QT was created, but I know there's some in Missouri, and that's probably a little bit more of a Missouri thing. But we don't have a gas station cult here. We need a gas station cult. We need a Wawa.
Yeah.
We need a Bucky's.
QT headquarters is in Tulsa.
There you go.
I don't think we're going to get either one of those.
We're not going to, but we need to create one.
There's not a lot of them.
Mega gas station. I mean, think about how many exits we have on our interstates that don't have any gas stations to get off there. And there's no consistency, right? So if you built a big truck stop, big travel stop location in the middle of Nebraska somewhere of a gas station that everybody's going to stop at, you got a real chance.
I love Love's.
You never really know. Oh, Love's is good.
Love's is a quality truck stop.
There's some in the western portion of the state that I utilized this past weekend.
There's one off of
144th. Yeah.
Right by
Way out there.
Warner, yeah.
It's brand new.
Yep. That's true. Maybe they're taking over. Who knows?
Iowa JD tweets at all of us, you're anti-Casey's pizza.
I don't know.
Choose your words carefully. Really?
Why? What gave off that impression?
It's just Iowa JD. You'd have to ask him.
Iowa JD? Don't worry. I'm an American. I like Casey's pizza. It's great. Breakfast pizza. I get it sometimes.
You know, you've met an Iowan when you say, hey, what's your favorite pizza? And they say Pizza Ranch or Casey's.
My grandparents, we'd go over to my grandparents' house, and the nearest business that they had to them at all was Casey's. And that's where they got their pizza.
Your grandparents live out in the country?
They do, yeah. Junietta.
Ah.
Mm-hmm.
I went out on one date in college with somebody from there.
No kidding!
And the only reason I know that is because I said, what's your hometown? And I looked up her hometown. I'm like, that's how it's pronounced?
Yeah, not Juanita.
It didn't last very long. She was attractive, though.
Interesting.
Yeah. It was one of those, like, you're a freshman in college, and, you're trying to show off, and it didn't last very long.
Interesting. I would imagine that somebody in my family knows who you're talking about here.
I can't remember her name.
Great.
Tall blonde.
Sure.
She was a science major.
Okay.
Ooh.
Probably now is living back home, probably has four kids.
Well, they're
now in school.
If you ever think about it, there's about an 80% chance somebody in my family knows this person.
Okay.
I like those odds.
A lot of kids spanning over a lot of generations. Yeah.
See, you,
it's not a big town.
You are fortunate enough in the dating world that you and your wife have been together for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
So you've never had like that person in the past that maybe, wasn't a long-term relationship, because I am the king of long-term relationships and long-distance relationships.
Nice. Congratulations.
But like somebody you went out with, you were in college, that you would like to research and see where they're at.
What are they up to?
Yeah. You maybe went out for a couple of months, didn't work out.
Not much of that, no.
Yeah.
You know, go on Facebook.
No.
That's a thing.
That is a thing. I believe you. Yeah. I would definitely look into that.
See if I messed up or not.
Did I sell that stock at the correct time? Turns out, yes. Yes, I did.
Nice.
Yeah, I dated in Lincoln. She went on, I don't know what she's doing now, because I looked her up like maybe 10 years ago. She was an executive at a professional sports team.
Mm.
And then another one who I went out with in high school is a high-ranking member in the state of Iowa.
Like the governor,
Kim Reynolds.
No, I did not go out with Kim Reynolds.
Now that would be awesome.
Yeah, I didn't know that, and I brought her name up on the air one time, and somebody said,
"You mean this person?"
Yeah, I brought up this person, and so somebody sent me like a Facebook like screenshot, and they go, "Whoa,
incredible!"
And I looked down, and I'm like, "Whoa, Jenny has a really good job."
Incredible. You ever think about working in government? I feel like I feel like I could work in government. It doesn't feel like you do a whole lot.
I think that's the appeal. Yes,
that's what I'm saying. Yeah,
I feel like I could
do a radio show and work in government at the same time.
I think it's been done before. I think KLIN's afternoon guy is in the state government or city government and does the afternoon drive time on KLIN and Lincoln.
Yeah, like Cody works
he works the DMV.
He works at the DMV. And he's traveling all across the country doing women's basketball games.
That just feels really on brand.
I think it's Cody's birthday or something.
It is his birthday.
Happy birthday, Matt.
Happy birthday, Matt.
You betcha.
Betcha. Please win tonight so we can get our postseason game at the Devaney.
Call you working in government.
Yeah. What do you think?
What part of government?
I don't know. It all seems
like,
pretty
do you
want to
be a representative? You want to be in Congress?
No, I don't want to be in charge of anything.
You want to be in the city council here? You want to be on some board?
No.
He just wants the pension and the paid days off.
Yeah, man. They get all those days off.
That usually happens when there's a government holiday.
But I also feel like I could do, like, you know, there's just
now we're going. Okay.
But there's
this
just so
is very
many,
on brand for you.
There's just so many examples of people who like work in government and also like are able to be successful in other areas of their life. Like,
they're called lobbyists.
I have a podcast too.
So you want a double dip?
Yeah. Like I think I could get a government job right now.
Okay.
And still keep my same job.
Okay.
I don't
so
know.
He's not asking to get a government job in order to work less and have more days off.
No. I just want more money.
Yeah, he's trying to double his income.
Yeah, I would basically be an Uber driver for the government.
Okay. And have a talk show.
It's called grinding. It's called using all my hours.
Okay.
Like, can't you work at home? Does all the government work at home now? Can I do a job that works at home?
So like Mike Flood, for example, who is now in Congress.
Yes.
He could still be running his TV station in Norfolk.
Which he does, right?
Yeah. I mean, I think he had to step away a little bit. But, you know, like you're just thinking he could come back and do like some anchor shifts.
Sure, why not? Step right in.
Sit on the desk.
Yeah.
They don't super him as Senator Mike Flood. It's Mike Flood.
Just Mike.
Yeah.
Mike Flood. So if anybody knows of any leads out there.
You know what you could do? You know what would be like for the city of Omaha? Which isn't necessarily a government job. You could be there, you know, you could be like the spokesperson in the media for a streetcar.
No, I wouldn't want to do that. I don't believe in it.
I read the Public Pulse.
Can't
the
fake
World
it.
Herald, so online, I go through the sports.
Oh, you've probably read my father-in-law's ramblings quite a bit.
What's his first name?
Barry.
Barry! What a father-in-law name.
Yeah, right.
I when you said that, I already knew. So Ricky Fulton is a big, you know, Public Pulse. He writes, he'll write us all.
The section?
Yes. That is
Gene Peck.
Brian Windhorst's father-in-law.
No kidding.
Yeah.
Oh,
so
wow.
Everybody in government, Ricky, who I believe he retired from the post office. He's kind of like the watchdog. Like he grinds the gears of the storm chasers because they're still Omaha and they're out in Sarpy County.
Okay.
Oh.
But yeah, that's Brian Windhorst's father-in-law, but he's very active in the Public Pulse. So I try and read the public pulse every day. Like, I miss the letters to the grandstand that used to be in the World Herald.
Yes, I do too.
I think we're on about a stretch of at least 6 or 7 months where nearly every day or every other day, there is a letter about the streetcar and none of it is positive. Like the one today just destroys.
We need more letters to the editor. Yeah. I don't know why that thing has been such a lightning rod.
Now, are you okay with your father-in-law doing this or?
Oh, sure. He needs a hobby.
Does he inform you when he's in the paper?
He asks for, hey, can you look this over? Make sure I've got the grammar right.
You proofread it?
My wife does.
Very good.
She helps her father out in that way.
So is he published frequently?
Yeah. Yeah. Happens, I don't know, monthly.
All right. What's like his best letter to the editor?
He's a big energy guy.
Okay.
That's the sector he worked in for
decades. Okay, so it's in his wheelhouse.
Yeah, yeah.
He's
very knowledgeable on the subject.
Okay, I probably quickly go by that.
What do we got in the public pulse today? Let's just see.
Oh, there's one on the streetcar, and it's pretty lengthy.
Driving Nebraskans away. Will of the voters, fentanyl facts, streetcar meetings. It's rather in your face for the streetcar authority to be inviting the public to meetings for input. Apparently, they haven't been reading the public pulse. They'll find what they're looking for. Has the word recall been mentioned? Atlee from Omaha.
Oh.
Every day.
Every day. Yeah, there's some good stuff in here. Nice. I gotta look at this more. I don't get a daily paper anymore, sadly. I know, you guys could boo me.
I'm not booing you. I'm not surprised. I mean, you're not alone. You're not paying $500 a
month. But there is something to the daily paper.
There is, and it's kind of sad that there's as much talent that has left the World Herald.
It really is.
Yeah, definitely.
That's okay. We'll have the Nebraska World Star before long.
The mega
when they combine.
World Star! World Star! The mega paper.
Yeah.
The Nebraska mega paper.
It'll cover Nebraska, Minneapolis, Kansas.
I mean, it's already that way online. Yeah. So,
well, you keep the sports staff separate and you combine all the new staff, which essentially it is.
The sports staffs aren't separate anymore. I don't know if you've noticed.
No, which is, but you still have competing columnists.
You do.
So you have Amy at the Journal Star and you have Tom at the World Herald.
Yeah.
Now, how much longer does that continue?
I have probably not very long. If we're being honest, probably not very long.
Because they share a beat writer for men's basketball. Or whoever's covering
covers men's basketball?
Well, I think Sam did. I think Sam finished up the
year. I think they sort of all tag teamed it this year. I think Amy was doing some of it.
Damn Jimmy.
Yeah. Jimmy just dipped. So the Bengals versus the Ravens.
So, I mean, it's tricky. Like, what happened if they combined, like, the prep coverage, which, you know, papers that are really struggling, they still write a lot about high schools because, you know, mom and dad.
Absolutely.
Going to buy the paper. Yep.
I would write a letter to the editor on that one.
So,
I can't have two RBIs, not three.
I think you have to keep high school sports coverage separate.
Yeah.
You know, do we really care about, you know, Raymond Central here in Omaha? The Raymond Central game?
No.
And they don't, and people in Lincoln probably don't really care about, you know, a Central South basketball game on a Tuesday night.
No, they probably do not. No.
I'm sensing a letter to the public pulse.
All right.
Okay.
I'm going to be looking for your father-in-law now.
Yeah, please do. Let me know what you find.
Have you ever written a letter?
To the editor?
Yeah.
No, I have not.
You just use your...
I just use the microphone that's in front of my face.
You just use your voice.
That's fair.
Yeah.
That's fair. I limit mine to just being on Yelp.
Oh
yeah, those are some good reviews over there.
Well, I went to a restaurant Sunday in Des Moines, and the beer was good. The food was terrible. And I felt like I should do a review.
Ooh. Gary, that's how you know it was bad.
Gary, you better go. Look at everybody's making their way down the hall.
No, it wasn't. I just felt like it's a good place in Des Moines. That the beer is good, but the food was just awful. Now, they did respond to me, so I appreciate that. I mean, okay. I wasn't like just absolutely crushing.
Sorry you had this experience. Let us know if we can make it any better.
Well, like the person, whoever is answering Yelp, said, if you are here again, please let us know.
Ooh. There you go.
How many stars?
I give it 2.
Okay.
2 out of 5?
2 out of 5.
That you hurts.
You big Yelp guy?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I check it out.
Or Google review. No. Write.
Oh, no. I don't write it. Because usually I enjoy my experience.
Well, then you should let them know as well. Nah. Not every review is supposed to be bad. I mean, Josh has good reviews on his movies. Some are bad, but some are good.
Yeah.
That's true. All right. I'll start to let people know.
It is a bit, though, there is a grocery store here in town, not one of the major grocery stores, but a, small community grocery store. If you read the reviews online of people that review this place, that is a good bit.
Oh, yeah.
That will keep you going for about an hour.
Well, we did that once on a crossover.
We did.
Did we? Is that, where we got it from? Yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
There have been more added to that grocery store. It's my favorite thing. Side of town.
So once a year I do it because I do this bit. I do this golf tournament with my friends, and it's a bit that we do on it. So I was glad to bring it to the air that day. I read them every year.
So that's a place where people are very opinionated on their meat and their service.
And their liquor.
And their liquor.
Mm-hmm.
Which must be a good thing.
And their oxtails.
I mean, people care.
And the people who frequent that business.
Yep. Yes, they do. All right. Have a good show.
Thank you, Gary. That is the crossover. We'll start things off next.
That's the crossover. The Connor Happer Show is next on 1620 The Zone. Previously on Unsportsmanlike Conduct.
I think a lot of the people that are looking at a deep run, they're looking at the numbers, they're looking at the analytics, and a lot of the folks who are a little more skeptical are going, yeah, but this is an inconsistent team.
That's where I'm at.
This is not a foreign concept. Teams that are at this spot in the season tend not to always be the best in terms of being able to string together great performances on a regular basis.
Unsportsmanlike Conduct with John Bishop and Josh Peterson. Weekdays 2 to 6 on 1620 The Zone. Your Omaha area forecast from the Godfather's Pizza Weather Center and KETV News Watch 7 on 1620 The Zone.
Playing on a cloudy and cooler Thursday, expect overcast skies for the majority of the day with a light northeast breeze. Some late day clearing is possible with highs in the mid-40s. I'm meteorologist Sean Everson from KETV News Watch 7.
Summer is almost here, and with 31 days in March, you can save $31 every month at Genesis Health Clubs. This offer will not extend. If you don't get started on your fitness goals today, then when? Tomorrow? Next week? Next month? Next year? Life's too short for that. Hi, I'm Rodney Steven with Genesis Health Clubs, here all month giving you 31 reasons to get started toward your summer fitness goals now. Reason number 22, maintains or improves joint flexibility. Reason number 23, exercise reduces your anxiety level. Reason number 24, exercise helps you to maintain a resting metabolic heart rate. Reason number 25, exercise helps to alleviate depression. Reason number 26, exercise increases your ability to adapt to cold environments. Reason number 27, exercise maintains or improves joint flexibility. 31 reasons to get started today and $31 to save every month when you get started at Genesis Health Clubs. This offer will not extend. There is no tomorrow for your health. Go to genesishealthclubs.com today to get started.
It's time for a March Madness update. The break from the madness is over, and the Sweet 16 tips off today. Coming up from New York City, it's the East Region semifinals with 4th-seeded Tennessee taking on 9th-seeded Florida Atlantic. Also at the Garden, Kansas State and Michigan State. In the West Region from Las Vegas, Arkansas against UConn and UCLA taking on Gonzaga. Hear Westwood One's exclusive coverage of the NCAA tournament right here.
Whether you own a local business or a global one, you know that these days, generating growth is a challenge. By teaming with Bank of America, you'll not just stay ahead of the curve, you'll move it. With access to experts, award-winning insights, and business solutions so powerful, you'll make every move matter, locally and globally. Visit bankofamerica.com/bankingforbusiness to learn more. What would you like the power to do? Copyright 2023 Bank of America N.A.
Spring is in sight. Looking to wake up your yard this season? Make your neighbors green with envy with Lenihah's wide selection of landscape supplies and homegrown plant material. Get a head start today. Lanahaw Nurseries, 192nd and Center.
Ever walk through a door and see all the trucks? Yeah. It's kind of like that at Gretna Auto Outlet. Half-ton trucks, three-quarter-ton trucks, dualies, gas or diesel. Gretna Auto Outlet will be happy to show it to you. They don't call it truck heaven for nothing, you know. Stop in the climate-controlled comfort of the indoor showroom or online with the virtual showroom at GretnaAuto.com. Gretna Auto Outlet, open Sundays too, just north of Nebraska Crossing on Highway 6 in Gretna.
What do you mean he went searching for fresher powder? We have full classes today.
Instructor down at Vesper Ski School.
Support each other to snowplow, honey. Not a way.
She needs more ski instructors to slalom through the day-to-day.
Pizza? Fries? Whoa, Braley, no. Pizza, pizza.
Indeed can help her hire great people fast.
I need Indeed.
Indeed you do. We instantly connect you with quality candidates whose resumes on Indeed match your job description. Visit Indeed.com/credit and get $75 towards your first sponsored job. Terms and conditions apply.
Nick Handley here for my friends at DJ's Dugout. If you're like me, you love March basketball. DJ's is the place to watch all of the exciting tournament games. DJ's has all the feeds to watch all the big tournament games on huge media walls at the same time. And cheer for Creighton with a Blue Jay lemonade, of course, plus great daily food and drink specials. DJ's Dugout is locally and Vietnam veteran owned. 7 metro locations. Dig in at the dugout.
The Blue Jays are going to the Sweet 16.
Coverage begins Friday at 6 with Robbie Lula. Then join me and Nick Baugh for all the play-by-play starting at 8. The Blue Jays in the Sweet 16, Friday on 1620 The Zone.
Equitable Bank. We take banking personally. EquitableOnline.com.
It's the Connor Happer Show. Are we sure we want to do this?
Could you, like, make an announcement that we're ready?
It's the Connor Happer Show on 1620 The Zone.
Hello, welcome in. Happy Thursday. It is the Connor Happer Show on 1620 The Zone and on 1620thezone.com. Connor Happer and Josh Hudson with you. What?
I had three cameras in there. I got rid of it. Don't worry. It's quick.
All right. Happy happy Thursday, everybody. Basketball is back on your television this evening. Doesn't have the same punch as it did last Thursday and Friday, but we'll be seeing some competitive games. Michigan State and K-State will start things off at 5:30 this evening.
People forget FAU and Tennessee are both in this tournament.
That is a real game. They'll play each other tonight at 8. In between those two games, Arkansas and UConn, which should be an absolute rock fight.
Yeah.
In Vegas. Could you imagine those two fan bases in that game in Vegas? That's fun.
Winning coach has to take his shirt off.
How about Vegas with their two games today? I mean, this is really good stuff. Arkansas, UConn, Gonzaga, UCLA.
Ooh, yeah.
In the night game. So
I like that nightcap.
The West Coasters will sneak in after the drunks. That'll be some fun times at T-Mobile Arena in Vegas tonight. UConn, a 4-point favorite. UCLA, a 1.5-point favorite. FAU Tennessee is a basketball game. One of those teams will be heading to the Elite Eight. And same with Michigan State and K-State, the other regional in Madison Square Garden, New York City, today. So those are our games today. And of course, four more tomorrow, which will include Creighton, who will play in the second to last game of the day against Princeton. They are the biggest favorite at the Sweet 16 round. We will ask the question today: what happens if Creighton makes the Final Four? Has anybody thought about this? Has anybody considered this possibility yet? What happens if little old Creighton makes the Final Four?
I haven't really thought about it much.
Yeah. It's sort of an odd thought, isn't it?
It could happen.
We'll talk that. We'll talk Husker football today as there was a little session of open practice. I have some questions that I have based off of that. Of course, the basketball this evening and a little bit of movement in the foreign NIL situation. Potentially, what's movement? I don't know, but at least it's a start of getting that ball rolling. Jacob Padilla will join us to talk basketball coming up at the top of the hour. Michael Bruntz in the noon hour to talk football, maybe a little baseball as well. And Josh, thank you. David Lesky, inside the crown. Why are we talking Royals? I don't know, but I'm happy to accept.
It is a week until opening day.
It is?
Yeah.
Wow.
And
I got to get my mind adjusted. I've been in basketball mode and World Baseball Classic mode.
Sometimes you just got to throw your host a bone.
God, I love that.
People forget we are a Royals affiliate.
Yes.
So, Connor,
are you gonna,
I'm going to let you go for a segment.
Are you gonna try and rein me in if I start asking questions about like who the 26th man on the roster is going to be?
Absolutely not.
What'd you think about Freddie Vermeen getting optioned yesterday? I thought that was kind of weird. What did you think, David? And he'll have this whole long take on it, and everybody listening will be like, what are you talking about?
Nope. Not going to rein you in at all.
Thank you.
This one's for you, okay? 11 segments are for the audience today. One is for you.
Let Connor cook. That's our lineup powered by the Rooferees at John Higgins Weather Guard. If you'd like to get in touch with the show, feel free to do so at Connor Happer, at Happer Show on the JTech Construction Zone Twitter feed. Email Connor at 1620thezone.com on the Equitable Bank inbox. And you can call or text, of course, 402-951-1620. So yesterday, the big news. Around college basketball, we were sort of waiting on one shoe to drop. Obviously, the Greg McDermott to Notre Dame stuff kind of came to a head yesterday. And then it was reported yesterday and should be announced today that the Penn State coach, Micah Shrewsbury, is expected to be hired by Notre Dame today. And for the moment, crisis is averted for Creighton.
Whew.
At least we think. And, you know, I wonder...
Are you breaking news?
No, I am not, Josh. Thank you for asking, but no, I am not. But for the moment, I think crisis is averted for Creighton, and that option, at least for Mac, I think is taken off the table. And so what happens next? Is there some sort of conversation about more money in Omaha and how that works, or is there another job that will come hunting now that, you know, the word is out, Greg McDermott is quote unquote available. I don't know if he's available, but you know, he's gone through the process one time. They ended up, from basically how I had heard this sort of, out explained over the last, probably a week or so, maybe a little more now, is Notre Dame was going after Shrewsbury, and that, you know, Mac was sort of in that conversation too, but candidate one was Mike Shrewsbury, and they pulled him out of Penn State. And from all accounts, it seems to be pretty difficult to do so. So I think maybe Creighton got a halfway decent break there, or at least, you know, if that's a leverage sort of card for Greg McDermott, that's sort of off the table a little bit in that situation too. So interesting development. It is still silly season in college basketball. More jobs will continue to come open. Remember, the thing that everybody says is next week is the Final Four. It's in Houston. Everybody's going to be in Houston. All the coaches, all the ADs.
It's like owners' meetings.
Everybody's going to be in Houston. Everybody's going to be talking to each other. They'll probably be bitching about NIL, you know, and all that stuff, and recruiting other players out of the portal and whatever comes through there. But there will be some movement as we continue out on throughout the weekend and into next week. Obviously, a few of the things in college basketball have already happened. The Ed Cooley boiling pot of water finally, you know, simmered down a little bit with him ending up at Georgetown, not for Providence, though. Providence still triggered by it. They've hired their guy in Kim English, 34-year-old coach who was playing at Missouri not very long ago, Josh. I'm starting to feel a bit old.
Yeah, that'll happen.
And Rick Pitino ended up at St. John's. Michael Shrewsbury at Notre Dame. There's been a couple more pieces of movement at some lower levels. I wonder what else might come open in the next week or so. Or if you're deciding that you're going to fire a guy in your university, you're going to make a change, would that have already happened? Or will there be a surprise piece of movement or two, like a retirement? Or we've seen a big retirement, obviously, already. But with Boeheim, but what happens as we continue on? So we're not out of the water just in terms of silly season yet. We'll see what happens in the next week. Maybe not so much things locally, but, you know, you never know. Nebraska women in Kansas in a WNIT rematch tonight in a game that went to triple overtime in Lincoln in December.
Ooh.
People forget that. First triple overtime game I've seen at PBA, I believe. That was a lot of fun.
Okay.
Everybody was wearing their Christmas sweaters. I believe it was in the middle of a horrible snowstorm, if I'm not mistaken. Something was going on. It was an early tip, and I don't think hardly anybody was there. It was a great game, one of the best games of the year. They'll play again tonight at Allen Fieldhouse. And if Nebraska wins, they have there is a decent chance they could be hosting the next round, but they will not be able to host at Pinnacle Bank Arena. Back in Devaney.
Okay.
Interesting. And by the way, in Nebraska baseball tomorrow are going to retire three of their greats, their numbers.
Mm-hmm.
Jane Comine, Darren Erstad, Alex Gordon. One thing that they did, and they tweeted it out yesterday. But I'd seen it last week when they played, or 2 weeks ago, I guess now, when they played Illinois State at home. Great addition, great tribute. Now, keep in mind the Haymarket Park wall is very short. It's probably about four and a half feet tall. So you don't have much room out there, but they added the College World Series logos and the unique College World Series logos from each of the College World Series teams that they've had in the right field corner.
Oh, neat.
Great move. And then in left field, I believe, right in front of the, you know, on the left field fence, they will add 4/28/17. 4/17/28 in whichever order you want to do it in.
Thanks, Salt Dog.
So a little bit of... yeah. Yeah. Hey, if anything ever gets held up over there, you keep saying that phrase. Thanks. Thanks, Salt Dogs. So, yeah, Nebraska adding a little bit of artwork to their outfield wall, which is a good thing and a tribute to the past and what Nebraska baseball has once been. So that'll be a cool ceremony tomorrow night. Hopefully the weather holds up. Creighton will also be hosting Minnesota at home in a game that was supposed to be in Minneapolis. And I believe they're still digging their way out of like 16 feet of snow.
That's correct.
So they will be down here tomorrow and Saturday. And I'll be on the Flow Sports stream.
Ooh.
Flow. Kevin.
How is your flow?
Not good, Josh.
Okay.
Take a look.
Oh, okay.
That's why I have to wear this Rockies hat.
Yes, if you're watching on the stream and you're wondering what hat Connor is wearing, that is a Rockies City Connect hat.
Mm-hmm.
Not, it's an alternate City Connect hat.
Mm-hmm. That's what I was told.
Anyway. Which is a thing that exists.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty sharp.
Got this.
State flag.
It's got this.
Rockies logo.
Yep. I'm a big Colorado guy now. People forget. People forget. All right. Jacob Padilla's coming up at the top of the hour. We'll be back with plenty more next on 1620 The Zone. But heading into weekend number two of the tournament this weekend, and you need to get on the action. There's no better place to do so with FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook right now. FanDuel is giving new customers a no-sweat first bet up to $1,000. First bet and no sweat. Up to $1,000 back in bonus bets if your first bet doesn't win. Just head to FanDuel.com/Happer and sign up today to claim your no-sweat first bet. Then you can wager on anything you'd like. And guess what? There's no sweat. One of the things that we do in betting is we sweat. No sweat. No stress whatsoever on your first one with FanDuel.com/Happer. And you can do so on an app that's safe, secure, and easy to use, so don't miss your shot. A no-sweat first bet up to $1,000 when you join FanDuel today. Just head over to FanDuel.com/Happer to sign up. Make every moment more with FanDuel. 21 and over, present in Iowa. First online real money wager only. $10 deposit required. Refund issued is now withdrawable bonus bets that expire in 14 days. Restrictions apply. See full terms at FanDuel.com/sportsbook. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-BETS-OFF.
Now live on Twitch, YouTube, and 1620thezone.com. Omaha Maverick baseball and softball seasons are underway, and single game tickets are on sale now for the entire season. All home games are played at Maverick Park. Summit League action can be seen all season long as both teams push toward the Summit League championships in May. Come on out and support your Mavericks at one of the finest baseball softball complexes in the Midwest. Get your single game tickets by calling 402-554-MAVS or by going to omavs.com/ticks.
Hi again, everybody. Kent Pavelka courtside with another matchup between the roofarees at John Higgins Weather Guard and the other average roofing companies. Now, quite frankly, this matchup is embarrassing. The expertise and superior service you get when you choose John Higgins Weather Guard for your roof, siding, and gutters is nothing short of dominating. Now, here's the deal. I've never seen this before, but every one of the other average roofers has fouled out. They're done. Don't foul out, folks. Make the right call with John Higgins Weather Guard.
Ask Sherwin-Williams during the spring sale, March 24th through April 3rd, and get 35% off paints and stains with prices starting at $28.92. That means 35% off our most popular color family, blue. Psychologists have found it to be soothing and relaxing, which makes it especially great for bedrooms and bathrooms. And of course, 35% off all of our other colors. Shop the sale online or visit your neighborhood Sherwin-Williams store. Retail sales only. Some exclusions apply. See store for details.
Does eating at home have you singing the blues? Stop by Cobb's at the Shadow Lake Town Center, 180th and Center, or 72nd and Jones to grab a delicious pizza, burgers, fresh salad, and some tasty charred wings. They even offer keto crusts and an extensive variety of shareable appetizers. Dine in, carry out, or delivery. Cobb's, now with three convenient locations to serve you. Shadow Lake Town Center, 180th and Center, and 72nd and Jones. Click CobbsPizza.com to see the menu. Pizza and so much more.
PACE, Police Athletics for Community Engagement Organization, is dedicated to preventing at-risk and disadvantaged inner-city children from becoming involved in street gangs, crime, drug use, and victimization. PACE provides an opportunity to develop discipline, self-esteem, and positive moral values through wholesome competition and free participation in soccer, baseball, CrossFit, and flag football. To help PACE and local families make sure kids have access to safe and fun spring and summer activities, please go to paceomaha.org to support the PACE mission. Thank you.
Hey, baseball fans, join the Blur tailgate at Hilton Omaha this June for our 11th annual hospitality event during the College Baseball Championship Series. Book an experience for your clients or employees with an inclusive bar, buffet, TVs, music, and tailgate games. Secure your spot today and let us handle all the details steps away on the south side of Charles Schwab Field. Visit blurevents.com to book your group, buy tickets, or learn about sponsorships. That's blurevents.com, your college baseball and football tailgate destination. Blur Events takes care of all the work so you can enjoy the day.
Hey everyone, Josh and John here for the FanDuel Sportsbook. March is almost done, but we have many more games to come this weekend. And right now, all customers can get up to $25 back each day if your parlay of three legs or more falls just one leg short. John, perhaps it's a side that one of our listeners likes. Maybe they're liking an over or an under or a prop bet. Whatever they do, be sure to go to FanDuel.com/1620.
And Josh, upsets have been the name of the day in this tournament. So even if that parlay of three legs or more falls just one leg short, you can get up to $25 back each day. Just sign into your FanDuel Sportsbook account, or if you don't already have one, FanDuel.com/1620. That's FanDuel.com/1620. 21 plus in President Iowa. Bonus issued is non-withdrawable bonus bets that expire 7 days after receipt. Max bonus bet $25 per day unless otherwise specified. Restrictions apply. See full terms at FanDuel.com/sportsbook. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-BETS-OFF.
Let's get back to the Connor Happer Show on 1620 The Zone.
Nebraska football let the media watch for 45 minutes today. Any takes on that, Josh?
That's a good amount of time.
Oh, yeah.
It's 45 chunk, minutes. Good chunk. Accessibility.
I mean, I think we're probably about 42 minutes. Previous staff. You want to talk about accessibility? You want to talk about transparency?
Nobody.
You got it.
Nobody threw a football, though.
Not that I saw. I have a question about that. So, for, once again, if you didn't hear my plea earlier, if you saw any video, maybe I missed it, I was in and out of Twitter, or if there was any video, just one, that featured Jeff Sims actually throwing a football in it. He looks great with a football in his hands. He looks great with a football helmet. But if anybody has an actual video of Jeff Sims throwing a football, please send it to me immediately. I just want to see it.
You want to fall in love.
Well, first impressions are really important, Josh.
Sure.
And I will base every take I have off him based on that one throw. I haven't seen it yet.
Well, Dan hits us up in the YouTube chat.
Dan!
According to a video by Mike Sauter, no footballs were thrown by quarterbacks while the media was there.
Holy God. They're keeping secrets.
Yeah. Not the open and honest communication from a coaching staff that you claimed, Connor.
Okay, hold on. Sauter, let's see this Sauter. Sauter's tweeting about football now? I thought Sauter was just tweeting about John Tonji in the transfer portal.
Go work the Jets beat. People forget Aaron Rodgers, still a Packer.
Yeah, he is, huh? I kind of forgot about that over the weekend.
Yeah. Not dragging it out at all.
There's got to be just some paperwork to do there, right? Mm-hmm,
absolutely. Just dotting I's and crossing T's.
Gotcha. Okay, so no footballs thrown at practice. This is a horrible mistake. Let the quarterbacks throw the footballs outside. I do have a question, a real question, though. When do we think we get to hear from Jeff Sims? I would like to hear from Jeff Sims. I mean, isn't he the assumed starting quarterback at this point in time? And I know there's the whole Casey Thompson thing that's still there. Although Casey's not practicing right now, been held out with the shoulder. When are we going to hear from Jeff Sims? I would like to hear from Jeff Sims.
I wouldn't think you'd get much further down the road without somebody putting him in front of some microphones.
Yeah.
Even for a couple minutes.
I think we heard from Heinrich Harburg the other day. I don't think that tells you anything, but I would like to hear from Jeff Sims. I hope that the first time we hear from him isn't like after the spring game or something like that.
No, that's far too late.
Yeah. So just want to see what he's up to, what he's thinking, what led him here, what was part of the pitch to bring him here. Okay, hold on. Now, Andrew just tweeted me a video.
Hi, Andrew.
That was actually tweeted by the Nebraska football account. Let's see. They're throwing footballs out of a jugs machine.
Ooh.
Oh, there were some footballs. Looks like after the media left. Balls thrown the practice before pro day. Andrew said that was that day. So that was a couple of days ago.
Is Jeff spinning it?
I don't know. I haven't seen the ball come out of it. I just need to see the ball come out of his hands.
Okay.
Just see how it comes off his fingertips. And I want to hear from Jeff Sims. This is now my demand of Husker football. I want to hear from Jeff Sims a little bit.
Make it happen, Husker media.
Yep. Got to request him, I suppose. I don't know. Maybe he has been requested and it just hasn't happened yet. We'll ask some of our guests, including Jacob Padilla, who's coming up next. Michael Bruntz. We will not ask David Lesky about if we should hear from Jeff Sims, although it'd be a funny bit if we did. All right, 951-1620. Always feel free to call or text into the show. Jacob Padilla, excuse me, to talk hoops next here on 1620 The Zone.
Live from the Host Coffee Studio, this is 1620 The Zone.
Hey, everybody, it's Michael Sevier for Rotella's Italian Bakery Bread. You know what's going on right now? Watching college basketball, right? You're probably watching the Huskers, you're watching Creighton, and you're probably hungry. You know what would be great? A sandwich, maybe even a hot dog, maybe even a brat or a hamburger. And the best way to do that is to head over to 108th and Harrison and pick up the bread first. It's over 100 years of tradition. It's great in the community and a high-quality product. That's what Rotella's does for you. So whatever kind of bread it is, you want to pick it up from Rotella's Italian Bread, over 100 years of tradition.
It's game day at Jim's house, and the spread is impressive.
Mike's already done some damage with the hot wings, and now he's dropping back and going deep for another slice of pizza.
I sure hope he brought the Pepto.
Mike knows the Pepto-Bismol provides fast, five-symptom relief from unexpected stomach upsets. He's no rookie.
The way he's throwing back those nachos, he's the GOAT.
Be ready for game day with Pepto-Bismol.
When you have nausea, heartburn, indigestion, upset stomach, diarrhea.
Use as directed. Keep out of reach of children.
Ever walk through a door and see all the trucks? Yeah, it's kind of like that at Gretna Auto Outlet. Half-ton trucks, three-quarter-ton trucks, dualies, gas or diesel. Gretna Auto Outlet will be happy to show it to you. They don't call it truck heaven for nothing, you know. Stop in the climate-controlled comfort of the indoor showroom or online with the virtual showroom at GretnaAuto.com. Gretna Auto Outlet, open Sundays too, just north of Nebraska Crossing on Highway 6 in Gretna.
Hi, this is Doug Nodgaard with Equitable Bank. Great service never goes out of style. When the digital age dawned, many said computers would be able to handle many of the interactions that used to take a person. Boy, were they wrong. How many times have you called your bank and gotten a recording to press 1 or 2? Not at Equitable. Not only does Equitable answer your call in the first ring, it's answered by a human being. That's because Equitable Bank values its customers. Equitable Bank, we take banking personally. Member FDIC.
I can't believe tax season is here already. But look at all this info I have to enter.
Phil's small accounting firm is growing in numbers.
Why didn't I take that typing class in high school?
A data entry specialist could really help him in a crunch.
I got blisters on my fingers.
Indeed can help him hire great people fast.
I need Indeed.
Indeed you do. You can schedule and conduct virtual interviews all from your employer dashboard. Visit Indeed.com/credit and get $75 towards your first sponsored job. Terms and conditions apply.
Hey everyone, Josh Peterson here for my friends at Kugler Vision. There is so much to do in Omaha in the spring, whether it's going to the ballpark, hiking on any of the local trails, or just hanging out on the patio and enjoying the breeze with friends. Why not see all of those things and more with the best vision you have had in your entire life? Kugler Vision, the only place in Nebraska that specializes in all 7 FDA-approved forms of modern vision correction. Schedule a consultation online today at KuglerVision.com.
One of the Nebraska Lottery's most explosively fun promotions is back. Cash Blast. Until April 18th, buy a 2x2 ticket, enter the voucher number, and you could win $5,000 or $500. If your winning voucher is from a 7-day draw ticket or a multiple of 7 ticket, your prize is doubled. There will be 7 weekly drawings and 14 total winners in Cash Blast. So play today. You'll have a blast. But that goes without saying. 2x2 top prize odds, 1 in 105,000.
Haven't played Powerball from the Nebraska Lottery in a while? It's easy, fun, and you could win a fortune. Visit your nearest Nebraska Lottery retailer. Pick 5 numbers between 1 and 69 and a Powerball number between 1 and 26. Or just ask the clerk for a quick pick. With the starting jackpot in the millions and drawings Monday, Wednesday, and Saturday, you'll soon remember why Powerball is Nebraska's favorite lotto game. Powerball top prize odds 1 in 292 million.
What I know about courage, I learned from my adoptive mom. She said sometimes you just gotta hold on and know we'll get through this.
Mom, we are so high up. Hold my hand.
No, you hold my hand.
Here we go.
Learn about adopting a teen from foster care. You can't imagine the reward. Visit AdoptUSKids.org to find out more.
I learned patience from my adoptive dad. All he had to say was,
"Hey, you got this. Just breathe." Hey, hey, we're pretty good.
Yeah.
Might have to start a band.
I got it.
Learn about adopting a teen from foster care. You can't imagine the reward. Visit AdoptUSKids.org to find out more. This message is brought to you by AdoptUSKids, the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, and the Ad Council.
Finding great people to hire is like trying to find a needle in a haystack. It's pretty difficult, right? Well, ZipRecruiter has mastered finding a needle in a haystack, so they take it to the next level. They make hiring so simple that it's like finding a needle in a needle stack. And that's why you should try ZipRecruiter for free at ZipRecruiter.com/radio. Here's what it's like to use ZipRecruiter. They have so many qualified candidates that it's easier to find the right ones for your roles. In fact, 4 out of 5 employers who post on ZipRecruiter get a quality candidate within the first day. That's a lot of needles. So how do they do it? ZipRecruiter's powerful technology sends you candidates who are a great match for your job, and you can even invite your top choices to apply. So if you want less hay and more needles, head to ZipRecruiter.
And right now, you can try ZipRecruiter for free. That's right, free, at ZipRecruiter.com/radio. That's ZipRecruiter.com/RADIO. ZipRecruiter.com/radio. ZipRecruiter, the smartest way to hire.
Shop Sid Dillon Chevrolet, where we sell more Chevys than anyone in Nebraska. Visit us in Blair, Crete, Fremont, or Wahoo, or at SidDillonChevy.com. Chevy, find new roads.
You are what drives us, Sid Dillon.
Tickets for Less. Best seats, best prices, no per ticket fees. TicketsForLess.com. KOZN Bellevue, Omaha, Council Bluffs. This is 1620 The Zone.
Now, the only cure for our basketball Jones. Hail Varsity's Jacob Padilla on the Connor Happer Show on 1620 The Zone, baby.
All right, welcome back, and we welcome in Jacob Padilla of Hail Varsity. We are on the backside of Padilla time. There's some football moved in today, spring practice with Nebraska. Jacob joins us on the phone now. Jacob, good morning. How are you?
Good morning, Connor. I'm doing well.
How was football today? Did you happen to see Jeff Sims throw a football?
I did, yes. He is a real person.
How did it go?
I didn't focus a lot on it. I was kind of bouncing around other places because they weren't actually like throwing to receivers, really. Just kind of going through some drills or whatever, but can't confirm that he exists and is at Nebraska. Can't judge how tight the spiral is or how accurate his throwing is at this point just yet. Maybe next week. Maybe we'll get a little bit more at the next open practice.
And when do you think we'll hear from him? I mean, as a guy who is the assumed sort of leader in the clubhouse for that race right now, we're starting to shift the conversation a little bit more toward football things. Like, do you think Jeff Sims will hear from Jeff Sims publicly soon?
I'm sure, yeah, at some point here. It's kind of random, it seems like, the players that they're giving to us. It's been all over the map.
Yeah, a lot of workout guys.
Yeah, so from returning, like, Quentin Newsom is speaking right now. I came up early, so I didn't get to hear what he had to say. But we had Quentin Newsom today, had Billy Kemp, the fourth transfer from Virginia, had Nash Hutmaker. We had Heinrich Harburg on Monday. And Gabe Irvin Jr. And Luke Reimer. And so it's just kind of been all over the map, from like starters to new guys to depth pieces. So we're just kind of getting a wide array of players that we're hearing from so far early on in spring.
What did you take away from, I know both the coordinators spoke today. Any big picture ideas you took away from that?
Not really. I didn't get to hear from Satterfield because I was over listening to the players, but Tony White talked about kind of the way that they're going through, like experimenting with positions and seeing guys out there. And they've moved a lot of guys already. You look at the roster update, you have different, you have some guys moving from one unit on the same side of the ball to another, or you have some guys flipping sides of the ball. And they're just kind of, it's early on in spring, they're experimenting, they're giving chances to guys to show where they fit best. And he mentioned John Bullock, the walk-on out of Creighton Prep, who they moved him to nickel last year. Now they've got him back at linebacker, and White said he just kept popping to him. He kept saying his name throughout these first two practices because he just kept showing up. And then Malcolm Hartzog, they're kind of moving him all around in the secondary. A little bit of safety, a little bit of nickel, obviously outside corner is what he played last year. So, and he's done well kind of wherever they put him. So those are probably the two standouts that first came to mind for Tony White when he was talking. But yeah, we're kind of in that place now where it's still early on, it's still installation, it's still experimentation. as the coaches and players try to kind of feel each other out and figure out, all right, what's the best look going to be for this team?
Yeah, out of the guys, and you just mentioned a couple, and there was a couple more mentioned, of course, on Monday by Rule, who underwent position change or are really just getting a fresh sort of outlook on, you know, on life, I guess, or on their careers at Nebraska with the new coaching staff. Is there anybody that stands out to you as far as, man, this would be, and this is just a moment where they seem to be really taking advantage of? We'll figure out more on these types of guys over the next couple weeks, but it feels like there's going to be a couple guys who maybe come out of nowhere and you say, wow, I didn't really expect that. Is there anybody on your radar?
Not just yet. I'm still trying to get a feel for the team. I mean, I wrote about my column today when I kind of like, or my column on Wednesday when I power ranked the kind of the positions that intrigue me the most going into the spring. I feel like I know the least about this team of any that I've covered, like going in, just because like the guys you have coming back aren't necessarily like all conference, like, oh, stud guys. Like you've got like, a lot of guys back that have played, but like they aren't big names necessarily. Like they're guys that you need to take a leap to get through that kind of all caliber status. So it's like, who are going to be the best players on this team? I have no idea.
Yeah.
Which of the returners are going to emerge, which of the newcomers are going to make the biggest impact. It's all just kind of like you said, fresh start, brand new, changing some things, and we'll see how that works. Obviously you've got guys like Xavier Betts and Isaiah Garcia Castaneda who are back with the program. And I know they, social media, they already put out the video or that picture of Xavier high pointing a ball, which is, easy to see why that Matt Rule was interested in giving a guy like that another chance if his heart is in it. So, it's still a little early on for me to kind of hone in on anybody right now, but there's like almost at every position you've got question marks and a lot of opportunity awaiting these guys here as we work through spring. And then it starts over again in the fall. You got some new guys kind of coming in that aren't here yet to push that thing even further. And we'll see if there's any further attrition. Obviously, they're still over the scholarship limit, but they're closer than they were before spring started. So so many moving parts right now.
Jacob Adil of Hill Varsity is with us. Big picture takeaways from the basketball over the weekend. The basketball tournament. Anything that really struck you just as far as like a big picture thing or a game that you really enjoyed? I mean, I guess where do you go first when you think about this past weekend?
Probably the game that I enjoyed most was that Creighton Baylor game.
Oh, that was a good game.
Pretty good.
Yeah.
That was fun. it's interesting. I just kind of went through like the other day and broke out the kind of on Torvik, you can adjust for like a time period. And I just looked at, all right, who were the top teams going into the tournament over the last month and a half? And it was basically the top seven teams, like the seventh highest rated teams are all still playing. And then after that, it was kind of, there was a big gap, like 12 of the, like the next 12 are all done. And one of them didn't even make the field. Like Michigan was playing like a top 20 team over the last month and a half of the season, and then one and done in the NIT. I found that kind of interesting. The teams that established themselves as the absolute best down the stretch, yeah, those teams are still playing. But some of the others that kind of rose up, like a team like Texas A&M and Duke and teams like that were really hot heading into the postseason, but maybe weren't. I mean, Duke went into the season thinking they were among that elite and then fell back and then kind of made that late push. But some of those teams that made late rises weren't necessarily able to sustain that in the tournament. But the teams that were really good all year long, I mean, you look at now, the top seven teams in KenPom are all still playing, like, season long. So we had some interesting, some upsets and some huge games from the first weekend. But at the top, I mean, the teams that look like the best, they're all still playing.
Where would you put Creighton amongst some of the best teams right now? I mean, there's such an interesting, because I don't know. I mean, they have the six next to them, and people, I think that sort of tricks people, even though they were a preseason, you know, top 10-ish team. You look at some of the analytics that have come out after the first weekend and really throughout the season, they still I mean, this is even, you know, statistically sort of proven out. They have one of the best, if not the best, starting five in the country that still exists. Like, where would you put Creighton's chances? I don't even know if we should do a like a results question, a Final Four or a national championship. But where would you rank them as far as the teams that are left?
Yeah, so right now, like on KenPom, they are the eighth best team, highest rated team remaining in the field. And it is interesting. You look at it kind of like the top six or the top five are all like really balanced teams. Like you look at them on both sides of the ball, they're all 21st or better on both offense and defense. That's Houston, Alabama, UCLA, UConn, and Texas. And I feel like, yeah, you definitely got to start with that five. And I mean, we've seen Creighton, they beat UConn. They took Texas down to the wire with a not 100% Kalkbrenner, even though he was great in that game, and not being able to make a three to save their lives. So like, yeah, I think you have to rank those teams ahead of Creighton, but I don't know that either one of them are like, oh, Creighton can't play with it. And then you start getting down to some of those other teams that aren't as balanced. You have Tennessee, who's elite defensively, but their offense leaves a lot to be desired, especially since Zakai Ziegler went down their point guard. Like, I'm very surprised they're still playing just based on how bad their offense has been. But then you've got Gonzaga, who is elite offensively. Like, Tennessee is number one in the country in defense. Gonzaga is number one in the country in offense. Gonzaga is 75th in defense. Tennessee is 60th in offense. So San Diego State's kind of like that as well. Fifth on defense, 70th on offense. Xavier is seventh on offense, 64th in defense. So a lot of these other teams that are kind of in that next tier below that top five, I think Creighton is in. Creighton's more balanced than any of those teams.
Yeah.
So I think you start that six through 10 range, I think Creighton is very clearly like in that mix. I think you can make a case for them being ahead of any of those other teams in that mix right now, just based on what we know they're capable of. The problem is their inconsistency is something that could pop up at any moment where no matter what you do, you just can't throw it in the ocean and that could end your season. Like, that's what has held this team back all year from being truly among the elite, like outside of the whole Kalkbrenner Mono thing. So like, that's always in the back of your mind, but when this team is playing well, I think they can play with almost anybody in the country.
Do you have any more sort of trust in the consistency part of it now? It feels like out of the last two weekends now, when you include the NCAA tournament weekend and then the Big East weekend, they had the one stinker against Xavier, but really the game against Baylor and the game against Villanova in the Big East tournament, those were two of the better games that they've played sort of all year. And it gives you the sort of dichotomy, like, okay, we have a really good game and then a really bad game literally the night after. But it was two reasonably consistent performances in the NCAA tournament's first weekend. I guess, do you have any more trust in them and the product that they're going to put out there on a nightly basis now? Or is it always going to come down to, hey, if you're making shots or not?
The making shots thing is the reason that you do feel at least a little bit of unease there. Like, defensively, you know they're going to come with a good game plan. They're going to play really hard on that end. And more often than not, they're going to execute at a really high level. So like, that part at this point, they've established that, like, hey, outside of that Big East final, or the semifinal, that was, I did not watch a single second of that game.
Yeah.
That was during the state tournament. I'm glad I didn't. I don't know exactly what happened in that game, but outside of that, like, you know what you're going to get from this team defensively. It's just, even in this tournament, they can throw it in the ocean. If they hit threes at even a slightly below average rate, then that game wouldn't have been competitive. And then obviously they shot the lights out, and that's how they beat Baylor in the second game. So I don't know that you feel 100% confident in like that's what they're going to be every single game, because they won both these games in very different ways on offense. But the fact that they're capable of doing that on the flip side is like, okay, yeah, they found a way to win when they weren't making shots. And they found a way to win when teams were daring them to make shots, which didn't necessarily happen at points early in the season. I mean, that's like Nebraska, like gambled that Creighton wouldn't be able to beat them from threes and took away everything else. And Baylor kind of did the same thing. They're like, all right, they saw what Kulfbrenner did in that first game. Like, all right, we can't let this guy beat us. And so they planned accordingly, and Creighton lit them up from the perimeter and hit 11 threes. So like, we know they're capable of it. It's just, in a one game setting, you don't know what you're going to get from a shooting perspective, which is, I mean, that's true for any basketball team.
Yeah.
Like, that's always going to be the case. Like, you can't ever 100% rely on it, but, this,
the variance is too wide.
Yeah, exactly. Right. This is extraordinarily up and down from a shooting perspective. So yeah, you don't go in feeling totally confident just because of that. Like, at any point, a bad shooting game could send you home. But I think Creighton's going to, everything else that they can control, even more so, they're going to put themselves in a position to keep playing here as we move forward.
Let me ask you this then. We'll talk about this later. You've been around and covered Creighton basketball for a long time. What happens if Creighton makes a Final Four, which is something that is actually realistically possible right now?
I mean, they might just tear down 72nd and Dodge. That intersection just might disappear entirely from the celebrations going on down there. it's hard, like, knowing that, like, Alabama's sitting there waiting.
Yeah.
Like, you got to get through the Princeton first. But, I mean, you probably feel more confident, despite Princeton obviously knocking out two very good teams. I think you feel more confident going into this game than maybe you did against Baylor, even though it's a very different style, but from a talent perspective and what Creighton has shown, I think you feel pretty good about that. But that Alabama game is a different story, just with how good they've been. A lot of people have them as the favorite to win it all.
Yep.
And to get to the Final Four, you got to go through that. For my bracket, I picked Creighton going to the Elite Eight and then losing to Bama there. So that's kind of where I'm at. Like, if they manage to do that, if they knock off Bama and go to the Final Four, then, I don't know what the reaction would be outside of just elation. And I think it just kind of what this team is showing right now is how I just hope fans, like, in general, like, learn to be a little bit more even keeled, because mid-season people had write in the obituary saying, McDermott wasted the best team that the program's ever had, and like all that kind of stuff, like what happened, and people were so down on it just because of the expectations were so high going in. And here we are to be right on track to meet those expectations. It took a kind of I had to take a detour, took the long road to get there, but they're still here. So it's just, for a team that had never had won like actual Sweet 16 in program history, to like one up that and kind of joked, like, obviously, Creighton went, the men went to the Sweet 16 2 years ago. Last year, the women went to the Elite Eight game. Tweeted that after last year. Well, your turn, Mac. Planning is to raise the bar. So now it's the men's turn to try to raise it even further. So just going to enjoy this run for whatever it is. And at this point, like, they've accomplished. I mean, they put themselves right in a position to accomplish everything that they were hoping for heading into the season. That's all you can ask for.
Yep. Tournament success makes you forget about a lot of things. That's for sure. Jacob, appreciate the time as always, man. And we'll talk to you later.
All right. Sounds good.
Jacob Padilla of HailVarsity.com. This will be tomorrow. People forget Creighton, Princeton, Sweet 16. Pre-game coverage begins at 6.
Right here on 1620 The Zone.
And the game can be heard here on 1620 The Zone, old terrestrial radio, at 8. I guess 7:30 pregame with John and Nick from the Yum Center, eating a KFC famous bowl or a snacker, RIP, I think. RIP? The snacker? Remember the KFC snacker?
Yeah, that's RIP. The double decker's back.
The double decker's back. You think John and Nick, you think they give them complimentary double deckers.
Yeah, it's just under the seat.
Everybody's just puking all over the floor. All right. Anyway, game will tip off at 8, but not on 1620thezone.com or our app. You can find the stream of it on the Varsity Network app, which is actually really nice and easy to navigate through from my experience with it last weekend. But this will be the first ever, according to Creighton stat man, Rob Anderson, first ever NCAA tournament game between a 15 and a 6.
Oh.
Yeah.
I expected there to be more there. And there just wasn't.
I mean, you would think that we've hit all the numbered matchups we can by then, but or by now, because considering the 16s that have won, the 15s that have won, and all that stuff. But tomorrow at the KFC Yum Center, it will be the home of the first ever NCAA tournament game between a 6 and a 15.
History at the Yum Center.
I think if you don't reseed them, obviously. You could obviously rank the teams 1 through 16 that are still left. I think, like we said, Creighton falls a little bit closer to the middle, maybe upper middle, that sort of thing, of how good they actually are. But it's sort of criminal that Creighton has a 6 seed next to it. You know? We know what they can be. We know what they can be. And what they weren't at some of the portions this year was halfway not their fault. And some of it was, but everybody has their sort of up and downs through a season. I just wonder, like, everybody will be picking. I'll be curious to see if Creighton gets through and if Alabama gets through. Like, what's that line look like originally to start off? Is it like 5, 6?
I was thinking 5.5 or 6.5. So
is that going to get hammered by,
I don't know.
I mean, because you're just betting on Creighton to have a nice offensive night, and they certainly could. They certainly could. And what's to lose at that point? You're in the Elite Eight. You're playing for matchup in the Final Four. Like I said, Creighton's still the fifth most likely team to win the national championship, according to our friends at the FanDuel Sports.
Wow.
This is crazy to think about. Also from Rob this morning, Louisville, home of the Louisville Bats, the Louisville Slugger.
Yes.
Have you ever been to the Louisville Slugger Museum?
I have not. I've heard it is worth the trip.
Really cool place. I don't know if it's worth the trip, but cool place. Like, if you're in Louisville, it's worth the trip of going to the Louisville Slugger Museum. But it's not just worth, hey, go to the Louisville Slugger Museum if you, like, live in Omaha. But the welcome gift to the coaches, the Sweet 16 coaches, was a bat.
Very nice bat.
A lovely bat. Just whipped them up over the last couple days. Coach Max says, Greg McDermott, 2023 NCAA Men's Basketball South Regional, Louisville, Kentucky. There you go.
Very nice.
What do you think they give him as welcome gifts in Vegas? Some of those stripper cards?
Couple chips.
Oh, that'd be good. That'd be good. I'd like to go with a personalized chip.
Mm-hmm.
It's not bad. How about New York? Slice of pizza?
Box of Sbarro.
And what are the other? What's the other site?
I don't know.
Kansas City.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Played a barbecue.
A wet nap.
just a nap in general. Take this complimentary nap on us after eating an entire plate of brisket and burnt ends. All right, we will come back. We'll discuss a little bit more Creighton coming back. Bruntz is going to be in the 1 o'clock hour now, so we still have Bruntz and David Lesky to come on the show today, or to come on the Connor Happer Show on 1620 The Zone.
Previously on Unsportsmanlike Conduct.
It's gotten to, like, people get, like, really after me on Twitter if they find out that I've had boneless wing.
Wow,
like,
really?
It's become, like, this thing where it's like, oh, you're going to lose your man card. Oh, that's why. You're the type of person that even says man card that you've already given up hope on me.
That's weird.
Oh, God. You don't spend enough time on Twitter, or you don't have enough crazies to tweet at you.
Unsportsmanlike Conduct with John Bishop and Josh Peterson. Weekdays 2 to 6 on 1620 The Zone.
Your Omaha area forecast from the Godfather's Pizza Weather Center and KETV News Watch 7 on 1620 The Zone.
Mostly cloudy and cool for your Thursday afternoon with highs today into the mid-40s, including for the Omaha Metro. Expect northerly winds up to 10 miles an hour, keeping us cool. Tonight, partly to mostly cloudy skies, staying chilly with a low near 30 degrees. I'm meteorologist Caitlin Harvey with KETV News Watch 7.
Omaha Maverick baseball and softball seasons are underway. Don't miss a pitch or a run scored. Single game tickets are available now. Come out and support your Mavs. Get your tickets by calling 402-554-MAVS or by going to omavs.com/ticks.
Shop Sid Dillon Chevrolet, where we sell more Chevys than anyone in Nebraska. Visit us in Blair, Crete, Fremont, or Wahoo, or at siddillonchevy.com. Chevy, find new roads.
Hey, everybody, it's Michael Savin, Rotella's Italian Bakery Bread. You know they've been doing it for over 100 years, taking care of your everyday baking needs, all types of bread. They celebrated that 100 years because they wanted to tell you about their tradition. It's a family business. That's what it is. Head over to 108th and Harrison, visit them or your nearest grocery store. Again, 100 years serving the community with high-quality bread products. Hot dog buns, hamburger buns, brat buns, whatever it is, check it out now. Rotella's Italian Bread, over 100 years of tradition.
Hi, this is Doug Nodgaard with Equitable Bank. Great service never goes out of style. When the digital age dawned, many said computers would be able to handle many of the interactions that used to take a person. Boy, were they wrong. How many times have you called your bank and gotten a recording to press 1 or 2? Not at Equitable. Not only does Equitable answer your call in the first ring, it's answered by a human being. That's because Equitable Bank values its customers. Equitable Bank, we take banking personally. Member FDIC.
Guys, let's face it. There is a time when you just need to get out of the house, to have your own place, to be with the guys, or just a quiet, relaxing place for yourself. Well, Hearth Cigars and Pipes Lounge hears you loud and clear. Settle in. Escape to Hearth Cigars and Pipes Lounge for an incredible selection, plus premium cocktails, a knowledgeable, friendly staff, state-of-the-art humidor, and incredible lounge. Hearth Cigars and Pipes Lounge, just off I-680 at 48th Street next to Covey's.
Does eating at home have you singing the blues? Stop by Cobb's at the Shadow Lake Town Center, 180th and Center, or 72nd and Jones to grab a delicious pizza, burgers, fresh salad, and some tasty charred wings. They even offer keto crusts and an extensive variety of shareable appetizers. Dine in, carry out, or delivery. Cobb's, now with 3 convenient locations to serve you. Shadow Lake Town Center, 180th and Center, and 72nd and Jones. Click CobbsPizza.com to see the menu. Pizza and so much more.
The Blue Jays are going to the Sweet 16.
Coverage begins Friday at 6 with Robbie Lula. Then join me and Nick Baugh for all the play-by-play starting at 8. The Blue Jays in the Sweet 16, Friday on 1620 The Zone.
Hey, people forget that Matchbox 20 is coming to Omaha on June 8th. They're bringing the Slow Dream Tour. Hopefully they won't be playing until 3 a.m.
Got him.
And they're with special guest Matt Nathanson. Tickets are on sale now through Ticketmaster. If you'd like to go and not pay, you could listen to Unsportsmanlike Conduct this week for your chance to win a pair. And you can find all of the details on our website at 1620thezone.com. Our friends at the Omaha Storm Chasers have released a alternate jersey today. People are actually excited about it.
Ooh, this thing is pretty.
This jersey is for you, Omaha. It says it's got the Omaha font, which I don't even know what it is, but you've seen it on signs.
Yeah,
it's got that little curly H.
It's on the building downtown.
Where is that?
You know, it's by the, I was afraid of this question because I know where it is, but not where it is.
Yeah, but yeah, where have I seen this before?
It's on the side of that building there.
Welcome.
You know, that building downtown.
Welcome to Omaha side. I mean, I've definitely seen it before. I just don't know where it is. All the pictures that I see on the internet are not of the sign that I'm talking about. But anyway, you would recognize the script if you saw it. It's on the new Omaha Storm Chasers alternate jersey, which is black,
And there's a grade A logo, like patch on the left shoulder, grade A beef.
Oh, okay. Okay.
I would think. So congratulations to the Storm Chasers. Oh, okay. The Storm Chasers fought us. Is the grade A stamp from the same ghost mural as on the Omaha script? I don't know what that means. But all right. Alternate jerseys. I think they got a Runza one out, which has some frings on it.
Ooh, yeah.
Excited for baseball to be back in town. We're a week away from opening day in Major League Baseball. People forget that.
It's apparently the Riley Building.
The Riley Building?
No.
The Riley Building. Aha.
Often has a Pinnacle Bank sign on it.
Mm. There it is. Oh, yeah. They take all the pictures of it.
Yeah.
It's always used during the College World Series.
Maybe you've been to a wedding or
Omaha
or your graduation photos were taken there or.
I'm sure I've seen it in real life. I don't recall seeing it in real life. I've only seen it on B-roll of the College World Series.
OAR's This Town music video.
This Town. Yeah. All right. By the way, Mitchell tweeted in.
Said
a gift for the people in Vegas. The Raiders. Just take the Raiders.
Just here, have it.
Every coach gets to co-own the Raiders from now on. All right, let me ask a question on Creighton basketball. I asked it to Jacob. Take it any which way you'd like. What happens if our little Creighton Blue Jays make the Final Four? This is a distinct situation that we need to be prepared for, Josh. They are one game away from playing for an opportunity to do so. They're two games away from actually doing it. I wouldn't call it all that unlikely that they're going to end up in the Final Four. I don't know if I'd pick them to beat Alabama straight up in a game. They could lose, too, by the way. I will pick them to beat Princeton. I think they'll beat Princeton. I don't know if I'd take them like on the spread, but that's all you need to do in the NCAA tournament. Just win the game. Spreads don't count.
Yeah, people forget that.
Reds don't count. Bet money lines in the NCAA tournament.
Although I did bet the spread for Creighton NC State. Thank you, Jays. -5.5.
Nice job by them. So, yeah, well, I bet them when they were +1.5, and I bet them on the money line, but they were still like -106 on the money line. And then like 10 minutes later, it flipped, and they were a 1.5 favorite against Baylor.
Nice.
And they were like -128 or something like that.
Just got right in there. I haven't given this much thought, like I said earlier.
What happens?
But, I mean, things... I want to say things change.
NCAA tournament success is sort of what this program has been missing. You know, it has been one of the most consistent programs in college basketball. You can expect them to win 20 games every year. You could expect them to be in the hunt for a conference title, and you could expect them to be in the NCAA tournament. Is the next step the public sort of saying, oh, no, I not only expect Creighton to be in the NCAA tournament, I expect them to be a top sort of 4 seed in the NCAA tournament, and I expect them to be in the second weekend of the NCAA tournament. Maybe that's the type of change that you can undergo when you do something like make a Final Four. All the attention that's put on you. And then you could say, in our last 3 NCAA tournaments, 22 and 21, if Creighton will have made the Final Four, they will have won in those tournaments a combined, 7 games? So that would be 4 this year if they're to make the Final Four. 1 last year and 2 the year before. 7 NCAA tournament wins in a 3-year span. I don't know how many teams have done that. Obviously, there's whichever team won the national championship is going to get 6. That's a tough ask, and to do it over 3 tournaments is obviously really good. And I'm not trying to put the cart in front of the horse with the whole getting to the Final Four thing. I'm just asking the question because I believe we need to be mentally prepared for this possibility.
Yeah, I do think,
and minds change a little bit around here, right? Don't you think that
the attitudes toward it changes a little bit. Well, I think there for a long time there's been this sort of I'm really happy to be here. I'm not sure. We got into this with Ravi on Monday, and there's been a lot of points in the last 10 years. No, I guess 20 really, where I thought, man, this is as good as it gets. This is so great. Mm-hmm. This is as good as it gets. You can go back to Corver. They have one of the best players in the country, or one of the most fun players in the country. And then you go on to, you know, consistently competing for and winning the Missouri Valley, getting to the NCAA tournament with guys like Funk and Tolliver and stuff like that. And then all of a sudden this guy named Doug rolls along and you're in the Big East and you're in the NCAA tournament every year. And now you're playing Duke and North Carolina in the NCAA tournament. You're like, damn, this is as good as it gets. And then you move on to the year after Doug left, and it's not so great, but here comes, here comes Maurice Watson and Kyrie Thomas and Justin Patton and all these guys. And you're like, man, that team was really, really good. And if they would have been hurt, that would have been as good as it got. And then here comes Tyshawn Alexander and Marcus Zagorowski, and they win the Big East. And you're like, and they, you know, they had the tournament canceled, but they probably wouldn't have won anyway because Zagorowski was hurt. But you're like, damn, I think that's probably about as good as it gets. And the tournament got canceled. And now this 2-year run with this group of guys. And you start to sort of wonder what does it feel like as we continue throughout Creighton basketball? At least as long as Mac's here.
Are you asking locally or nationally?
I guess both.
Because I think it feels different. I think nationally you're more like a George Mason or a Loyola. Where, oh, here's this plucky little team that nobody really knows where their school's located.
Okay. That's
making the Final Four. Like, obviously they've had more consistent success than George Mason or Loyola, but
okay. But can you take it? Can you change the script? Can you change the narrative on yourself nationally from that? I don't think you're that far off, Josh. Maybe not at all. Can you take it for, but they're in the Big East Conference, right?
Right.
Can you say, no, actually we are
Gonzaga.
We are Villanova.
Yeah.
We are Gonzaga.
Yeah. I think you can do that weekend in Houston.
Does a Final Four appearance take you to that level?
Through interviews and branding, you know, news stories can kind of educate, like, no, we're not the little school that could. We're actually in a major conference in a major city and, you know, educate the public. But I don't know if you're immediately going to change hearts and minds like that on a national level.
I think locally, I keep getting pleasantly surprised.
Mm-hmm.
And I think some of that comes from, I don't know how much better it gets, or B, I don't know how much longer this is going to last. Like I hope this is like this forever, but you sort of want to be content about it and not say, man, I wish that we could have got a little bit more out of that. Because you just don't know. I mean, it's a program that is blazing sort of a new path. It's in a new conference. But it still has its limitations in being a small school. So I wonder how the minds change both locally and nationally if Creighton all of a sudden shows up in a Final Four. And importantly, I think in this specific case with this team, they look the part because they do. They look the part.
Yeah, definitely.
They have one of the best starting fives in the country. They can match up athletically with just about anybody. Alabama will be tough, obviously.
Yeah, you'll have the talking heads like Jay Billis and the CBS guys, Jay Wright especially, like, being on that broadcast would talk up how real deal Creighton is.
Like, how is it framed? You know, like, how is it
exactly?
How is it framed from a national? Like, is this a fun story, or is this, or do they talk about what the last 10 and then 20 years of Creighton basketball has been, and then people sort of realize, oh my God, I didn't realize Creighton has been that good for the last 20 years. They really?
I think
they
that's win, the way it would be.
They win 20 games every single year. They've been in however many NCAA tournaments since, you know, the turn of the century. I don't know how many it is now.
And now they have two Sweet 16 banners to hold up. And this is recent history too. Like, obviously we're not talking about the blue bloods of college basketball and all that stuff, but you know, there have been moments of these. I mean, Villanova is an example of this. They just hit this really great run. And maybe it lasts 10 years, maybe it lasts 15 years, maybe it lasts 20 years. There's always a build up to it. Creighton's had the build up to it, and now maybe they're in it, or maybe this is just the beginning. I don't know what to think. They're sort of still blazing that trail. So I wonder how it's framed if Creighton is to make the Final Four. Now they have that number, little number six by them, and that probably doesn't help them. But they do, they're going to be able to match up with whoever, I mean, relatively well. It won't just be like, it's a team that got hot for a couple weeks. I hope not anyway, because that doesn't do justice to this team. Although, yes, they do have that little number six by them. a couple emails here for the Equitable Bank inbox. Adam.
Hi, Adam.
Creighton's nowhere close to being compared to George Mason or Loyola. They're a Big East school. People have heard of them nationally much more than George Mason or Loyola. Just because someone in New York might not know where Creighton is located doesn't mean they haven't heard of them. I'd be that same person. I bet that same person in New York has also heard of Gonzaga, but couldn't tell you where Gonzaga is located. No, Josh, I get your point, though. I don't know if those are programs. You know, those are a little bit closer to Cinderella stories than I think where Creighton is.
Yeah, it's somewhere in between a George Mason and a Gonzaga.
Yeah. There's an element of randomness to it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And I think you could, you know, Creighton won its first ever, I believe, Creighton won its first ever NCAA game on Sunday where they were not the higher seed.
Oh.
I believe that's the case. I felt like that was a Rob tweet at some point this weekend, or maybe in a Rob note. Somebody correct me if I'm wrong on that. I believe this is the first. No, that can't be the case. That can't be the case because they had the Terrell Taylor upset, right? What? Anyway, all right. Sorry, that was completely wrong. Gosh, I can't remember what that stat was, though. There was something in that sort of neighborhood. If anybody could help me on that, I'd appreciate it. Obviously, I don't know what I'm talking about. Great job by me.
Terrific. We'll cut that out. It'll be fine.
bullet point Bob. Here we go.
Oh.
Let's see what this is all about.
Oh, no. Hi, Bob.
If Creighton makes the Final Four, I think their fans should buy a gigantic thank you card for McDermott and wish him well as he leaves. His stock will never be higher, and if Cooley is getting $6 million while McDermott is getting $1.5 million, we don't know that, by the way, he should get the hell out of town. Creighton fans should also start fundraising because $1.5 million won't cut it for a Big East coach going forward. I don't disagree on that point.
Yeah, that's absolutely true.
You're going to need to pay more money. Platt Cat says at Happer Show, you're wrong. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
I know.
No.
I already admitted that. Omaha Gators tweets in.
Hi, Gators.
Says, this sounds like Butler had tournament success and then reached a final.
Yeah, that's better. That's better.
And could be the case here, maybe or maybe not. You know, they weren't able to hang on to their coach.
Mm-hmm.
They weren't able to hang on to their coach that got them there.
Yeah. I like this analogy better than mine.
Can Creighton avoid that fate?
Mm-hmm.
It's possible. Or, as they've done, because, you know, another thing that Creighton has done, their last two coaches have been the right hires. They have hired the right guys.
Yeah.
And they've been really, really good. So can they, you know, if they were to lose Mac at some point, I'm not saying this year, we're not talking about that piece. But if they were to lose Mac at some point, if they could avoid the, or if they fall to the same fate as Butler did, can they get it right for a third time in a row? The odds are against you. Seriously, the odds are against you. It doesn't usually work that way. So I think that's where the sort of, you know, happy to be here conversation kind of comes from a little bit as well. All right. Any more thoughts on that? We take them. I don't know what that stat was. I thought about it for 10 more seconds and it can't be true. It's definitely not true. Thank you, Platt Cat. You are wrong.
Hey, you got to hold us accountable.
We just need to take that tweet actually and make it our like header on Twitter, because it just says at Happer Show. You're wrong, and I think that's a pretty good encapsulation of our show.
I like it.
By the way, one quick Husker thing before we take a break here. This is from Sam McEwen. OC Marcus Satterfield said Nebraska football coaches are into pickleball.
Oh, no.
Rule, quote, beat the brakes off of his assistants. 30-0, apparently.
Wow. 30-0.
So not only is Matt Rule a pickleball guy, Matt Rule is a try-hard pickleball guy.
Getting after it.
Yikes.
Look.
So I guess this is a pickleball state now.
I'm going to ask the question.
This is the best thing that's ever happened to pickleball in the state of Nebraska, by the way.
This is true. Full-throated endorsement from the head football coach. It doesn't get much bigger than that.
Yep.
Do we believe he actually won 30-0?
I believe that Matt Rule is definitely a tryhard. Not in a bad way.
Yeah.
But I believe that there would be no room for breathing if you were playing Matt Rule. Like if he, same thing with ping pong.
Do you think
like he's up 14-0? It's like, no, you're not getting a point. I'm not letting you have one.
Do you think at like 6 or 7-0, the other players were like, okay, this guy wants it more than me. I'm just going to let him have it so I can go.
I don't know. I don't feel like he'll let anybody breathe in that situation. One more Creighton thing actually from Adam.
Oh,
hi. A good point. Butler didn't have the Big East money or notoriety when they made their run. That was from the text line. So it's a different situation. How long can you hang on to the coach? How long can you afford to pay him? And if you are not, can you capitalize off of the success that you've had and make it a good run the next time around? And make it a good hire the next time around. Like I said, the odds are against you. Option A would be to keep the guy in charge. Odd news is next on 1620 The Zone, but the tournament is heating up, and there's no better place to get in the action than the FanDuel Sportsbook, which is America's number one sportsbook, because right now FanDuel is giving new customers a no-sweat first bet up to $1,000. $1,000 back in bonus bets if your first bet doesn't win. Just head over to FanDuel.com/Happer, H-A-P-P-E-R, and sign up today to claim your no-sweat first bet. Then you can wager on everything from the money line to point spreads, which team will be cutting down the net. Like I said, Creighton is the fifth best odds to win the national championship. If you like them to get to the Final Four, that's a nice little underdog bet. I don't like them to beat Alabama in the Elite Eight round, but it's no sweat. That's the beauty of this with FanDuel Sportsbook. /Happer, you can head there right now and get in on the action, or you can do it all on the app, which is safe, secure, and easy to use. So don't miss your shot at a no-sweat first bet up to $1,000 when you join FanDuel today. Go to FanDuel.com/Happer to sign up. Make every moment more with FanDuel, 21 and over, present in Iowa. First online real money wager only. $10 deposit required. Refund issued with as non-withdrawable bonus bets that expire in 14 days. Restrictions apply. See full terms at FanDuel.com/sportsbook. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-BETS-OFF.
Omaha's most listened to all sports radio station. Again and again and again. 1620 The Zone.
Hey everyone, Josh and John here for the FanDuel Sportsbook. March is almost done, but we have many more games to come this weekend. And right now, all customers can get up to $25 back each day if your parlay of 3 legs or more falls just 1 leg short. John, perhaps it's a side that one of our listeners likes. Maybe they're liking an over or an under or a prop bet. Whatever they do, be sure to go to FanDuel.com/1620.
And Josh, upsets have been the name of the day in this tournament. So even if that parlay of 3 legs or more falls just 1 leg short, you can get up to $25 back each day. Just sign into your FanDuel Sportsbook account, or if you don't already have one, FanDuel.com/1620. That's FanDuel.com/1620. 21 plus in President Iowa. Bonus issued is non-withdrawable bonus bets that expire 7 days after receipt. Max bonus bet $25 per day unless otherwise specified. Restrictions apply. See full terms at FanDuel.com/sportsbook. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-BETS-OFF.
Peerless Energy Systems is Nebraska and Iowa's locally owned and operated authorized solar air compressor distributor. Peerless Energy Systems provides products and solutions for compressed air systems, helping companies in manufacturing, food processing, transportation, auto body repair, car dealers, and more. Driving industry efficiency through service, support, and relationships, let Peerless Energy Systems help you increase efficiency with your compressed air systems today. PeerlessEnergy.com.
What was it some famous football coach once said? Attitude isn't just one thing, it's the only thing. Well, here's an opportunity where your positive attitude is going to take your career to amazing places. Meet Scott Wood, general manager at McCarthy's 1 Hour Heating and Air and Benjamin Franklin Plumbing.
The type of people that I'm looking for is people that are really motivated to take care of customers. Always do the right thing. If they always take care of the customer and do the right thing, I will always do what I can to take care of them. We have a really rock solid team. We can't do half of what we do without any single person. Our job is to provide a service. We provide a service of heating and cooling to customers at the time that they need it. You know, that's really the mindset that I look for.
Along with being a fantastic place to work, the benefits are top shelf, and they'll even train the right individual. Right now, McCarthy's 1 Hour and Benjamin Franklin Plumbing is looking for HVAC techs and plumbers. So work with a company that wants to work with you. Click the career tab at McCarthy's1Hour.com. That's McCarthy's1Hour.com. McCarthy's 1 Hour Heating and Air and Benjamin Franklin Plumbing, equal opportunity employer.
The Dell Technologies semi-annual sale starts now with limited quantity deals on select performance PCs powered by 12th Gen Intel Core processors. Save on select Vostro laptops with built-in security features and select Latitude laptops with enhanced privacy, collaboration, and connectivity. Save on select essential accessories plus free shipping and special financing with Dell Business Credit. Call a Dell Technologies advisor at 877-ASK-DELL. That's 877-ASK-DELL.
The Blue Jays are going to the Sweet 16!
Coverage begins Friday at 6 with Robbie Lula. Then join me and Nick Baugh for all the play-by-play starting at 8. The Blue Jays in the Sweet 16, Friday on 1620 The Zone.
I switched to Boost Mobile and got a free Samsung Galaxy A23 5G phone. Want to know the best part?
It was free?
Nope.
The fact that it's on America's largest 5G networks?
Nope. It's the ding.
Oh yeah, love the ding.
Right? It's all about the ding. It's the dingarooski, the dingarona, the ring-a-ding-ding.
Unleash your power to save with Boost. Get a free Samsung Galaxy A23 5G phone when you switch. Boost Mobile, unleash your power.
And the ding.
Limited time offer, new customers only. Available on select networks. 5G not available everywhere. One device per line. Tax excluded. Additional restrictions apply. See your local Boost Mobile store for details.
Hey, it's Happer for the FanDuel Sportsbook, and we are headed into week 2 of the tournament, and there's no better place to get in on the action than FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook, because right now, FanDuel is giving new customers a no-sweat first bet up to $1,000 back in bonus bets if your first bet doesn't win. Just go to FanDuel.com/Happer and sign up today and claim your no-sweat first bet. You could wager on anything and everything from the money line to the point spreads, which team will be cutting down the net at the end. You look at some of our matchups this weekend, and there are definitely a few that are ripe for the picking. Maybe you like the Blue Jays to win 2 and go all the way to Houston. You can do that on the FanDuel Sportsbook along with plenty, plenty more. So don't miss out on your shot at a no-sweat first bet up to $1,000 when you join FanDuel today. Just go to FanDuel.com/Happer to sign up. Make every moment more with FanDuel. 21 and over, present in Iowa. First online real money wager only. $10 deposit required. Refund issued is null. Withdrawable bonus bets that expire in 14 days. Restrictions apply. See full terms at FanDuel.com/Sportsbook. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-BETS.
Tickets for less. Best seats, best prices, no per ticket fees. Ticketsforless.com. KOZN Bellevue, Omaha, Council Bluffs. This is 1620 The Zone.
And now we've reached the point in the show where Josh Hodson reads the peculiar, the bizarre, the comical, the odd news with Oddson. Odd News, Oddson. See what we did there? The Odd News with Oddson.
A lot of feedback on the pickleball revelation here.
It's the big story of the day.
Joel tweets in at Happer Show. Is pickleball the new golden tee?
Poll question?
I don't know.
Are we ready to rock the boat?
Hate rocking the boat. I had to turn the light on. I realized how dark it was on my face. And then we get a couple of texts on it as well. A good one. Matt Rule has other hobbies than football. Let's see how this works out.
Oh, great point. This did not come up during the interview process.
I thought Matt Rule was supposed to be working all the time. Mm-hmm. Doesn't get time to crush his opponents 30-0 in pickleball.
Think Trev makes his way down Like, hey guys, hey, didn't know you had hobbies. What else don't I know? What's going on down here, guys?
What the heck is going on over here? And there was another comment that I must
bust.
Oh yeah. Here we go. Matt on the Equitable Bank inbox.
Hi, Matt.
This 30-0 thing is some serious Kim Jong-un shooting 54 at golf vibes. Yeah, he beat us 30-0. I don't want to talk about it.
Mm-hmm.
That's my boss, you know.
That's sort of where my head was at.
And one more from John on pickleball.
Hi, John.
So Ravi's already infected the new Nebraska football coaching staff. I guess it's a sickness, by the way, the pickleball thing. It's a pandemic, if you will.
Ooh.
But I plan on getting my vaccines.
For pickleball?
Yeah. Okay. Or maybe I'll just succumb to it. I'll just say, you know what? It's time to play pickleball. I haven't chosen yet because I haven't played pickleball.
I'm going to get immunized against
pickleball. Josh has the odd news.
I do. We begin with Johnny Manziel.
What's Johnny up to?
Well, he's...
Does he still have a money phone?
Well, I think he does. He's hitting up the beach. Went Wednesday. He got paid a visit by a bird. Who...
What are you talking about?
Defecated on his head.
So the story here is Johnny Manziel got crapped on by a bird?
Yeah. The hysterical moment happened while the former Heisman Trophy winner was soaking in some rays in Miami with his girlfriend, Kenzie Werner. In the video, Werner shared on her social media page, you can see Manziel got crapped on and then was absolutely flummoxed over what had just happened. Is that bleep on my head? He asked. Werner, like the rest of us, was laughing way too hard to answer. If you don't get that camera out of my face, he said with a huge grin, and get it off of me, I'm going to wipe it on your whole bleeping body, he said.
So he didn't know that he had been crapped on?
It appears like, hey, can you confirm that what I think just happened?
Gotcha.
Now, Werner did help out her man, but not before she took a photo and captioned it, my poopy boy.
And a video of herself just kind of going like this.
Well, yeah.
Johnny, I hope you're okay.
I hope so, too.
That's all I got to say.
Mm-hmm. Connor, how do you feel about funny obituaries?
Death, usually not funny.
Okay.
Funny obituaries can make it easier.
Haley Milner of Georgia shared on Facebook the obituary she wrote for her father, Illinois resident Kenneth Joseph Pluar Jr.
Rest in peace.
A woman from Georgia has gone viral after writing a hilarious obituary. He died after losing a battle with sepsis. While admitted into an intensive care unit at a local hospital in Illinois, she described her father as an outdoorsy person who was hard as nails and stubborn. His three loves were hunting, fishing, and drinking, according to Milner. He also enjoyed his love of country and Western music, both kinds.
Mm-hmm.
Like every sad cowboy song, he couldn't stay married, but that didn't keep him from trying. Again and again, Milner wrote of her father. He had a total of 4 legal marriages and divorces and 1 common law marriage under his belt.
Wow.
Milner noted that she is Pluhar's only known child. And that she too is a mother of 1.
Wow.
Kenneth,
only 1 kid out of 5 marriages?
Yeah, that's kind of odd. You don't see that every day. Kenneth had a green thumb, was outdoorsy, and a skilled carpenter. This meant that he was great at growing his own weed and was champion of hide and seek for $2,000 a week when he worked for the union, the daughter wrote. He actually was a halfway decent carpenter. People bragged about his craftsmanship. If you could convince him to show up and work, which most people weren't capable of accomplishing, the eulogy continues. I don't know that this is as funny as the article thinks it is.
This guy just kind of goes by the beat of his own drum, it sounds like, which is normal.
Daughter sounds like she's kind of grinding an axe against her father.
A little bit.
Milner wrote that While Pluhar was known to start fights, he had a strong friendship that spanned 50 years. She noted her father was emotionally unavailable and yet overly sensitive, all rolled into one.
Well, this is sad, kind of, actually.
Yeah. Interesting.
A texter writes in, is this guy Ron Swanson?
A little bit, it seems like.
So what did he die of?
Sepsis.
What's that?
I have looked this up before.
How is that spelled?
S-E-P-S-I-S. It's a body's extreme response to an infection. Infection you already have triggers a chain reaction throughout your body.
Wonder what kind of... I mean, he's a serial monogamist, it seems like.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Wonder what kind of infection he had.
Yeah. Finally, we turn to...
Justice. Yeah.
The world of CeeLo Green.
Yeah. Yeah.
What's your thoughts on CeeLo Green? Pro?
Oh! Con? And then I drive around town with the bleep you. Yeah, I love that guy.
Okay.
Yeah.
Would you be interested in watching a video of him falling off a horse?
Is he okay?
Yeah, he's fine.
Yes, okay. I would be.
During an event in Atlanta celebrating the birthday of late rapper Shawty Low.
Shawty L.O. died?
Yeah. Oh, is it pronounced L.O.?
Well, he did L.O., L.O., They Know.
No, I don't know.
Well, They Know is one of his most popular songs.
Okay.
So he sometimes went Shawty L.O., Shawty Low. Shawty Low is fine, too.
Okay. Fellow Atlantan CeeLo Green attempted to make a grand entrance, and things did not go as planned.
Man, that shakes me up, bro.
Things look troubled Shawty from the start. My condolences to you, Connor. In the short clip, CeeLo can be seen awkwardly straddling a horse as two other men guide the animal inside a busy venue. Horses can be excitable, and it appears the combination of flashing lights, music, and a very loud DJ was too much for the horse to handle. Add to the fact that nightclub floors are not the best surfaces for horses to be on.
Yeah.
And what you have is a recipe for disaster.
Yeah.
Eventually, the DJ advised that CeeLo be taken off the horse, but the warning came about 5 seconds too late. Despite the chaotic scene, it is good to see Atlanta honoring Shawty Low.
It is.
On what would have been his 47th birthday.
Wow.
Connor, Shawty has been dead for 7 years now.
7 years?
Yes, he was involved in an automobile accident.
I was not able to properly mourn his death.
That took his life in 2016.
I never heard about that. How tall do you think CeeLo Green is?
I will say 5'2".
He looks kind of short.
Yeah.
CeeLo Green height. 5'7", the internet's telling
me.
No. You're saying he's a whole 2 inches taller than Bruno Mars.
Okay. Danny DeVito's 4'10", for reference.
Yeah. Yeah. I got to see this video. CeeLo Green horse.
Yeah, it's a good video. You can see, like I said from the beginning, that this is going to end poorly. Because he just doesn't look right sitting atop that horse.
No, he's pretty... What kind of horse is that? All right, here we go. The horse seems to be quite... Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it's a full-on horse in a nightclub. It's a terrible environment for a horse.
The horse is a bit aggravated. CeeLo does not appear to know what's going to happen to him next. I get a tweet from a former co-host of mine, Michael Snow.
Hi, Michael.
Went to a CeeLo Green concert in Omaha once, and the entire venue cleared out after he played that one song everyone knows.
Sure.
It was sad.
Absolutely.
I would stay along for Bright Lights, Big City.
Why would he not play that last?
That's a good question. You think he just comes out with it? Dun, dun,
dun, dun, okay, dun, now dun, it's just dun, for the real fans.
Let's see those top songs. Well, he's got Bleep You, and then he's got the edited version of it, which are his top two songs.
That's not a good sign.
On Spotify. Kung Fu Fighting? And then Bright Lights, Bigger City.
Okay.
That's what I said. I would stay for that one. He's been featured in a few songs as well. He's got a unique voice.
Does he regale us with stories from his time as a coach on The Voice?
Oh.
In between songs?
I didn't know that happened.
A little bit.
I would go to his. I would stay the whole CeeLo concert. Why not? He probably does some covers too. I got a lot of respect for CeeLo. Not a lot of people do.
He's not my Ed Cooley. No, thank you.
thank you, Josh.
Thank you, Connor.
That is the odd news. Mr. Rick says that eulogy sounded a little bit more like a Festivus than a tribute.
It really did.
And then Mr. Rick adds that I went to a funeral like that last week. You ever been to a happy funeral? I never have.
I have been to a happy funeral, yes.
What has to happen in order for it to be a happy funeral?
You have to alert everyone before they walk through the door. Hey, this is a celebration of life. This okay. is not a sad occasion.
Okay.
Like, there's a lot of legwork that has to be done on the front end. You can't just say,
oh yeah, you got to set this. You got to set the tone.
Yeah. You cannot just say, okay, everybody
be happy.
This is a happy place.
Yeah. I wonder in which situations that happens. Like, is it just a really old person? Or is it a guy who just likes to party and then you use the excuse of like, he would have loved us to just drink 100 beers
mm-hmm.
and just get absolutely hammered out of our minds and everybody be really happy and invite a horse to the club. This is what he would have wanted. I love that. I love that phrase, by the way. This is what he would have wanted. How do you know that? How do you know that? Are you sure about that?
Yeah, that phrase is probably a little overused.
But it's okay. Sure. The person's dead.
Uh-huh. They can't correct you.
All right. Thank you, Josh.
Thank you, Connor.
Great odd news today. Mm-hmm. Noon Hour is coming up next. Once again, we'll still be joined by Michael Bruntz and David Lesky in the 1 o'clock hour. More to come on the Connor Happer Show on 1620 The Zone.
Live from the Host Coffee Studio, this is 1620 The Zone.
Hey everyone, Josh Peterson here for my friends at Kugler Vision. It is spring break season. How about you take a break from those glasses and contacts? Give them a call today at 402-558-2211 or schedule a consultation online at kuglervision.com. Email on sportsmanlike conduct on the Equitable Bank Zone Inbox with whatever is on your mind, from your hot takes to what you think is one. The Zone Inbox is brought to you by Equitable Bank. We take banking personally. We want to hear from you on the Equitable Bank Zone Inbox.
John Party. That's why they call me Mr. Saturday Night World Tour. Friday, October 20th, Baxter Arena with special guests Midland, Ella Langley, and DJ Hi-Max.
Got a little dirt on my boots, but I'm taking you uptown.
John Party.
Last night only.
On sale Friday at 10 a.m. at Ticketmaster.com. Don't miss John Party Live.
Ever walk through a door and see all the trucks? Yeah, it's kind of like that at Gretna Auto Outlet. Half-ton trucks, three-quarter-ton trucks, dualies, gas or diesel, Gretna Auto Outlet will be happy to show it to you. They don't call it truck heaven for nothing, you know. Stop in the climate-controlled comfort of the indoor showroom or online with the virtual showroom at GretnaAuto.com. Gretna Auto Outlet, open Sundays too, just north of Nebraska Crossing on Highway 6 in Gretna.
Did you know that radon is the number one cause of lung cancer for non-smokers and that our region has some of the highest levels in the country? Radon Defense Midwest can test and fix your home. Visit RadonRadio.com for an exclusive offer for 1620 The Zone listeners. That's RadonRadio.com.
Nick Handley here for my friends at DJ's Dugout. If you're like me, you love March basketball. DJ's is the place to watch all of the exciting tournament games. DJ's has all the feeds to watch all the big tournament games on huge media walls at the same time. And cheer for Creighton with a Blue Jay lemonade, of course, plus great daily food and drink specials. DJ's Dugout is locally and Vietnam veteran-owned. 7 metro locations. Dig in at the Dugout.
Hey, baseball fans, join the Blur tailgate at Hilton Omaha this June for our 11th annual hospitality event during the College Baseball Championship Series. Book an experience for your clients or employees with an inclusive bar, buffet, TVs, music, and tailgate games. Secure your spot today and let us handle all the details steps away on the south side of Charles Schwab Field. Visit BlurEvents.com to book your group, buy tickets, or learn about sponsorships. That's BlurEvents.com, your college baseball and football tailgate destination. Blur Events takes care of all the work so you can enjoy the day.
Hey everyone, Josh and John here for the FanDuel Sportsbook. The tournament is heating up, and of course, there's no better place to get in on the action than on FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook. Right now, FanDuel giving new customers a no-sweat first bet for up to $1,000. That means $1,000 back in bonus bets if your first bet does not win. John, all they got to do is go to FanDuel.com/1620 and sign up today to claim that no sweat first bet.
Josh, while upsets are a big deal in weekend number one, after the first weekend, watch for the higher seeds to rise to the top. This is when the big boys start to play. Don't miss your shot at a no-sweat first bet up to $1,000 when you join FanDuel today. Go to FanDuel.com/1620 to sign up. 21 plus in present in Iowa. First online real money wager only. $10 deposit required. Refund issued as non-withdrawable bonus bets that expire in 14 days. Restrictions apply. See full terms at FanDuel.com/sportsbook. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-BETS-OFF.
Let's get back to the Connor Happer Show on 1620 The Zone.
Here comes the clown.
All right, a couple things here in the previous segment. First, I like this one from the text line. Brian.
Hi, Brian.
Next hit comedy on CBS, a ghost haunts his family after they throw a funeral. Quote, he wouldn't have won it.
That's three seasons minimum. Right
there's
there.
There's been worse shows made than that.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Remember Two Broke Girls?
I think
this is way better than that.
Mayim Bialik currently is on a sitcom where she runs a cat cafe. So yeah, no.
Really?
Yeah.
A cat cafe? Mm-hmm. What happens at a cat cafe?
Well, there is, it's a coffee shop, but there's cats around for you to cuddle with.
Oh, like the cats live there?
Yeah.
Oh. You ever hung out with a cat? You ever go somewhere and there's a cat there?
I have, yeah.
I hate it. Guy I stayed with this weekend, his girlfriend has a cat.
Ooh, yeah.
Cat's really nice.
Oh, that's good.
Love the cat, but there's just like hair everywhere, stuff like that. That's okay. I mean, it didn't bother me that much.
Sounded like it did.
The dogs are at least a little bit more like. I mean, the dogs are more cumbersome, right? Like, the dogs are going to get in your way more, and you have to, like, care about dogs more.
Yeah, there's more work. It's more of a commitment.
So the cat maybe is an alternative, even though it doesn't do anything.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Should we talk about Dylan Raiola to meet our quota for the week?
Dylan? Is he here?
Dylan? I think tomorrow.
Spits hot fire.
Are we going to have flight trackers on Dylan? On flight Dylan Air tomorrow?
There is almost literally nothing that would surprise me about this visit.
I mean, he's bringing in a lot. I mean, Matt Rhule and his staff and Dylan. We'll talk about it tomorrow with Munson, of course, but a lot of people coming in.
Large contingents on both sides.
Not just a lot of people, but a lot of really, really good recruits. Well, let's go back to something that Mitch Sherman said yesterday, and he wrote about a little bit as well. The idea, do you think we can oversell at all the importance of the family environment in the recruitment of Dylan Raiola?
I mean, ideologically, it's where they both align.
Right.
Right?
This is the thing that Nebraska has in their back pocket. Right. So this is the thing that Nebraska needs to be sort of selling the most. I'll read you back a couple quotes that Mitch Public published in The Athletic from his family members the other day. And one of them was from his sister, Taylor. Said he's going to go to the school where he feels the best about the family of people that he has around him. And then not long after that in the story, Dominic, Dylan's father, said, "It's not wins or losses," Dominic said when discussing his approach to football with sons Dylan and Dayton. "It's doing things the right way." And then he's talking about Rhule a little bit. Obviously, we know from talking to Dom that the appreciation that the Raiola family has toward Matt Rhule is pretty strong.
right? And a lot of that, I think a lot of that happens because the bar was set maybe a little bit low coming off of the previous coaching staff. That's okay. We'll take what we can get in this situation. But I feel like the pushback on Dylan Raiola and his potential like commitment to Nebraska, and people would sort of come back to earth and they would say, well, I'm just going to have to hear more of his family really likes the people here in order to think that Dylan's actually going to go to Nebraska. When actually, I think that's the reason why he might commit to Nebraska. That's the reason why Nebraska has a shot. And that is Nebraska's, in this situation. He can, I think you look around at the other schools, and obviously Nebraska has to meet a certain level in terms of facilities and in terms of winning football games and all that stuff, but they believe in Matt Rhule that way too. But if you look at USC, it's about Heisman trophies. If you look at Georgia, it's about national championships. If you look at Nebraska and what does Nebraska have over those schools, or what advantage can they gain over those schools? It's the family atmosphere. It's the environment that you're in. And whether it sounds hokey or not, I do think that's Nebraska's sort of edge in this recruitment. That's what they're going after. They can't say, hey, you're going to come here and win a Heisman. They can't tell people that. Because it's not, they don't have the proof of performance behind that.
For most people outside of Nebraska, it probably doesn't sound like enough. Like, it doesn't sound like
right
anything substantial at all. Like, that's, hey, what are you doing, Nebraska? That's not a pitch.
Right.
Ah, but it is.
It's real. It's the real deal.
Mm-hmm.
And if he could bring, some of his friends along with him in the recruiting cycle, I think that sort of matters too. And being somewhere now, it has to check out from the football side. But I just don't think that part of it can be oversold, because I believe that's what Nebraska is sort of going after here.
Got to know who you're selling to.
Yeah.
Not just what you're selling.
And I think Dylan's going to make the decision, but obviously his family is a really important part of his life. And, it's not always exactly one-to-one. Whoever has the best relationship with the kid or with the parents is ultimately going to get him. He still's got to make that decision, but it's a great inroad to have. So he'll come up here this weekend, and he'll have a whole bunch of people with him, and he'll have a whole bunch of recruits from the 2023 or 2024 class. And they'll try and all get together and make it seem like a family atmosphere, and also say, show them the pieces that you've been talking about. If you're Matt Rhule, I think that's what Nebraska can accomplish this weekend as well. Show them the pieces that you're talking about. You come here, we're going to develop you. How do you develop? Well, we're going to coach you hard. We're going to be engaged in practice, and it is going to be a family atmosphere. And yes, we're all going to play ping pong and pickleball, I guess, together. And there'll be a player this weekend who like tweet out, is like, coach, I need one more game in pickleball, or I need one more game in ping pong. Remember that whole thing with Malachi Coleman in the winter. Hopefully that'll sort of happen. So there's that piece of it. And then there's the football piece of it as well. I'm glad they get to see a practice or two. And whatever it might mean in that regard. So I wouldn't underrate that piece of it. I do think it's important, and it's easy to roll your eyes and say, oh, okay, that's really Nebraska's shot here. Yeah. Yeah. I actually think it kind of is. One more thing today. This is from Ross Dellinger.
Hi, Ross.
Ross is not texting this or tweeting this into the show. but maybe potentially a little movement on the foreign NIL situation, which just so happens to have a pretty big impact on a few players in the Nebraska men's and women's basketball programs. When you talk about Keisei Tominaga or Jazz Shelley or Izzy Bourne. So there are a couple senators who have now urged with a letter Homeland Security, to grant international college athletes the right to earn NIL. Which if you think about it, it's crazy. I mean, it messes with their visas and stuff like that. And that's why they're not able to do it in the first place. There's specific rules and workarounds that they can get through. And keep in mind, I don't know how fast this may move, if at all, or anything like that. But it's good to hear that it's an issue being sort of worked on and thought about. Whether it works for people like Casey Tominaga or Jazz or Izzy, or it has to be, you know, a couple of years down the line where something like this gets tidied up a little bit, it should be done. It should be done. And I mean, in a lot of cases, I mean, think about Tominaga, just for example. I mean, there's a lot of the intrigue about him that is specific and unique to him, specifically because he is a foreign student, because he is an international student, right? Like, if you think about the brand of Keisei Tominaga. Like, imagine if Shohei Ohtani was, like, playing college baseball or something like that.
Yeah.
He couldn't earn. I don't know. You wouldn't be able to make that comparison really whatsoever. But great news, Josh. Letters are being written to the Department of Homeland Security, which is great.
And if there's anything we learned today on the crossover, it's that government work goes quick.
That's right. This, I'm sure, will go to the top of the front of the stack of papers that the Homeland Security Secretary has in front of his desk right now.
Straight to the top.
Yep. I'd imagine that this is the case.
Fast track it.
Let's see here. Chris on the text line.
Hi, Chris.
Got to play ping pong. The Golden Tee machine is gone. You think the Golden Tee machine was still in there? Remember they did that visit and the
and we all saw it.
We saw the picture.
Oh my gosh!
Yeah. And then Chris on the text line as well on the Raiola situation. He says I spent a lot of time in Hawaii, and you could also not underestimate how important family is for the people of Hawaiian Samoan heritage. Every weekend, the parks and beaches are filled with extended families of four generations for Sunday barbecue. Things like that. No, I think that matters in this case too. It's the family on one hand, but it's also in the sort of culture and heritage of, you know, who the Raiolas are as well. I just don't think that part of it can be undersold. So if he finds a place that could feel like family and home here, and it's really involved and it's really special, that matters in his recruitment. And it may matter more than winning national championships or winning Heisman trophies. There's obviously a football component to this stuff, but I mean, I think that part has been, undersold maybe a little bit by us. And I think Josh characterized it pretty well.
Thank you.
Like if you're in the national media and you're thinking about, well, is he going to go to Nebraska or USC or Georgia? And what's Nebraska's pitch to him? And it's like, oh, well, he really likes it there and he has a good relationship with Matt Rhule. That doesn't sound like enough, but it might be. And his parents have a really good relationship with Matt Rhule. That might not sound like enough, but it actually might be in this scenario. Oh, here's a great question that could open some things up on our text line.
Ooh.
Unnamed texter. What's with the Golden Tee machine? I hear references all the time on this show. Well, long story short, unnamed texter. The previous coach liked to play Golden Tee. Some would say a lot. Maybe he was a little bit too competitive. Golden Tee. Maybe he's a little obsessed with Golden Tee. But there was a lot of Golden Tee going on in the former coach's sort of area. I guess that's sort of long story short, but yeah. It's just another way of us to poke fun at Scott Frost, to put it really simply that way. All right, 402-951-1620. The hotline, you could call in there, and the text line, you could text in there as well at Happer Show, at Connor Happer on Twitter. Michael Bruntz will join us at about 1:30. David Lesky will talk Royals at 1 o'clock this afternoon. But let's take a quick break and we'll come back. We'll take a phone call after this. So Hang on right there to Walter. We'll be back with more next on 1620 The Zone.
Mornings with Sharp and Handley.
So people said the man bun.
Yeah.
Do you know that that's not what it's called this day?
What is it called these days?
It is called, I wrote this down, a top knot.
A top knot?
I did not know that.
I like so that better than a man bun.
It has gone from the man bun to the top knot. That's how it is described.
Okay, I need to transition into that because it's man bun, it's been thrown out there so many times, easy to use. Top knot, now that's kind of fun.
Yeah, okay.
Mornings with Sharp and Handley, weekdays 6 to 10 on 1620 The Zone. Your Omaha area forecast from the Godfather's Pizza Weather Center and KETV News Watch 7 on 1620 The Zone.
Mostly cloudy and cool for your Thursday afternoon with highs today into the mid-40s, including for the Omaha Metro. Expect northerly winds up to 10 miles an hour, keeping us cool. Tonight, partly to mostly cloudy skies, staying chilly with a low near 30 degrees. I'm meteorologist Caitlin Harvey with KETV News Watch 7.
More with Connor and Josh after this.
We're going to have an extensive professional relationship, my man.
On 1620, The Zone.
Many people go back to the dealership out of habit or because they think the dealer is the only one who knows how to fix their car. At Omaha Car Care, we offer a better option. We have ASE certified technicians, the technology to service any vehicle, and free loaner cars. The dealer will sell you a package of services. We'll provide the service you want for your car as your trusted partner. I'm Rick Betker, owner of Omaha Car Care, and we'll be along for the ride.
Email us on the Equitable inbox with whatever is on your mind. The Zone inbox is brought to you by Equitable Bank. We take banking personally. You can hit me up, agree, disagree, tell me your thoughts on life at Hanley at 1620thezone.com. We want to hear from you on the Equitable Bank Zone inbox.
The spring yard cleanup season is here. Lenaha produces Omaha's finest mulch. The best colors, best value, and the best quality. There is a difference. Have us deliver or stop by for convenient on-site loading. Rooted in quality, unmatched value. Lenaha Nurseries, 192nd and Center.
Hey everyone, Josh Peterson here from my friends at Union Omaha. It is the fourth season and it's about to begin coming up on Sunday, March the 26th at 2 o'clock. You can get tickets now at unionomaha.com for their home opener at UNO's Coniglia Field. You will not want to miss out on the action throughout this year. I have had so much fun going to matches over the last few seasons. I look forward to going to them in year four. UnionOmaha.com.
Ask Sherwin-Williams during the spring sale, March 24th through April 3rd, and get 35% off paints and stains with prices starting at $28.92. That means 35% off our most popular color family, blue. Psychologists have found it to be soothing and relaxing, which makes it especially great for bedrooms and bathrooms. And of course, 35% off all of our other colors. Shop the sale online or visit your neighborhood Sherwin-Williams store. Retail sales only. Some exclusions apply. See store for details.
Businesses of Omaha, settling for a website that looks like it's stuck in the early 2000s? Then it's time to level up with JM Online. Our local team builds custom websites that solve unique business needs. We're not your typical web design company. We're your partners in online success. Ready to take your website to the next level? Go to jmonline.com and request an initial call.
What do you mean he went searching for fresher powder? We have full classes today.
Instructor down at Vesper Ski School.
We toured each other to snowplow, honey, not a way.
She needs more ski instructors to slalom through the day-to-day.
Pizza? Fries? Whoa, Braylee, no, pizza, pizza!
Indeed can help her hire great people fast.
I need Indeed.
Indeed you do. We instantly connect you with quality candidates whose resumes on Indeed match your job description. Visit Indeed.com/credit and get $75 towards your first sponsored job. Terms and conditions apply.
Hey, it's Happer for the FanDuel Sportsbook, and we are headed into week two of the tournament, and there's no better place to get in on the action than FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook, because right now, FanDuel is giving new customers a no-sweat first bet up to $1,000 back in bonus bets if your first bet doesn't win. Just go to FanDuel.com/Happer and sign up today and claim your no-sweat first bet. You could wager on anything and everything from the money line to the point spreads, which team will be cutting down the net at the end. You look at some of our matchups this weekend, and there are definitely a few that are ripe for the picking. Maybe you like the Blue Jays to win two and go all the way to Houston. You can do that on the FanDuel Sportsbook along with plenty, plenty more. So don't miss out on your shot at a no-sweat first bet up to $1,000. When you join FanDuel today, just go to FanDuel.com/Happer to sign up. Make every moment more with FanDuel. 21 and over, present in Iowa. First online real money wager only. $10 deposit required. Refund issued is non-withdrawable bonus bets that expire in 14 days. Restrictions apply. See full terms at FanDuel.com/sportsbook. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-BETS-OFF.
Make the right call, fans. The Rooferies at John Higgins Weather Guard.
Rooferies.
Welcome back. More of the Connor Happer Show here on 1620 The Zone and on 1620thezone.com. Quick phone call in a second, but reminder, this week's Zone deal is to Rib Shack Smokehouse, known for its southern taste of down-home soul food and barbecue, smoked wings, collard greens, mac and cheese, and plenty more. 108th and Q in Omaha. And of course, this week you get two $25 vouchers, which is a $50 value for just $25. Zone deal this Friday, tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock, 1620thezone.com. To the phones, we find a phone call from Walter on the line. Walter, good afternoon. How are you?
Hey, good. Great show again, guys. I appreciate you.
Yeah, appreciate you.
Hey, I got a question for you. With Raiola, basically the comment came out that family is very important, which it is from that perspective. Instead of him, if he does come here, instead of him even staying in a dorm, can he stay with his uncle? I mean, that's a big plus. You look at the family coming all the time. They've got some place to stay. He's got some place to go. Even if he's struggling, he still has some place to go. You know, familiar with the food that he eats. I mean, I think those things are the family things that I think that they're talking about.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts on that? I'm not even sure if he can do that. Does he have to stay on campus or what?
Walter, do you mean like live with him?
Yes.
I wouldn't think that he would want to do that. I certainly wouldn't want to as a college kid, but I mean, it is nice. It is nice to have him there.
Mm-hmm.
That's sort of how I feel about it. Appreciate the call, Walter. Thank you.
No problem.
Yeah, I think, you know, I'm an 18-year-old kid. I don't want to live with my uncle in college. I don't think a lot of kids, now I know the Raiolas are maybe a little bit more family-oriented than some of them out there. I would think that a lot of 18-year-old kids feel the same way. I would not want to live with my uncle when I went to college.
Not my uncle who is on the coaching staff.
Correct.
That's, yeah.
I wouldn't live with my uncle at all, but my uncle on the coaching staff, definitely not.
Hey guys, come over to the house.
Like, yeah.
No.
Well, it's good to have him there, though. Family's in town and stuff like that. Is it allowed? I wouldn't know. I guess I don't think so. Usually they make them live in the dorms in the first year or in the housing that they put them in, but I don't know. I would assume that Matt Rhule has some of the rules on that one, you know, where the kids are.
You just assume he knows all the rules because his name is Matt Rhule.
Well, I do. Yeah. Rules. But the family environment piece is, it's notable, even if he's not living with Uncle Donnie. One other thing, not to bring up old stuff.
Oh.
Did you see the story in The Athletic today from one Bruce Feldman?
No.
Entitled, "The First Year is the Hardest, How College Football Coaches Get Their New Teams to Buy In."
I have seen this article. I have not read it.
When I saw the headline, I thought, "Ah, there's probably a bit about Scott Frost in there." And then I saw the picture, and there's Scott Frost right in the picture, along with Sonny Dykes, who things went decidedly different for in year one, and Rich Rod, who probably not so good either. So here's the bits on Frost. I want to just read you sort of this section of the story. Sometimes the same coach who thrives in one transition flops in the next one. In December of 2015, Scott Frost took over a UCF team that went 0-12 before he arrived in Orlando. In his debut season, the Knights made a bowl game. In his second year, they went 13-0. Then he left. Frost didn't achieve one winning season in his 5 years with Nebraska, going 16-31. His predecessor finished 19-19. Two of Frost's assistants, who were with him at both schools and were granted anonymity to speak candidly about their experiences, say the opposing personalities they followed played a factor. Quote, at UCF, we were following George O'Leary, who was a real hard ass, said one assistant. At Nebraska, we were following Mike Riley, who was a nice guy. So it felt like a fire that we never put out. The other assistant concurred. At UCF, they just wanted people to love them up and make football fun again, he said. Those kids wanted to be great. They wanted to be loved and understood. We were a young staff. We'd play noon basketball. Frost would be playing too, and the players were jumping into it with us. Practices were short and fun. We coached off of emotion. At Nebraska, I'd think they'd been chasing recruiting stars, and we ended up letting more things go. The lack of accountability seemed to be the Huskers' undoing, as they lost a stunning amount of tight games. Frost teams were 2-8 in games decided by 3 points or less. Gosh, I hadn't seen that stat. Everybody talks about the touchdown or less. I didn't see the 2-8 and 3 points or less. How's that one hit? I actually, you know, for as often as we sort of get on Frost and his staff are like for piling on at first and not making the most of what they did sort of right at first, right when they got here, I really do think there's something to be said for just, I mean, what you want is for coaches to be who they are and have their sort of coaching style. And I think this is more of a commentary on what Nebraska needed at the time. Really, if you want to blame one person, I don't think Nebraska probably could have got away with not hiring Scott Frost in that moment, regardless of what Nebraska may have needed at that exact moment. But personality wise, I do think the point is important there. It was a little relaxed, I think, at the end or throughout the Mike Riley era. They let those guys sort of be themselves. And I think that was, in a way, sort of similar about the way they wanted to approach it. I mean, Frost and his assistants were not coming from a place where they really had to coach hard. So from that standpoint, I would say that Nebraska's in a really good situation. I mean, if you want to bring it to right now, don't you think that sounds like a situation that is pretty ripe for the picking for Matt Rhule and his staff? I think he's got a bunch of guys, in that locker room, and I think he had it at the time, who were just looking for some direction. Frost had it when he got here, and wasn't able to sort of point it in the right way, and now I think Rhule sees sort of the same when he looks out amongst his guys right now and says, man, we got a bunch of guys who want to win, who are hungry and have a lot of energy, and they just need to sort of be guided in the right direction. So, I mean, you could make the, this doesn't come off as like another, here goes Scott blaming the old staff again. No, or even his former assistants. Blame this. That really didn't come off to me that way. I thought it was a little bit more of, this is who we were. And honestly, I mean, in the quotes, there's a little bit of responsibility taken for it. He said, look, one of the assistants in the anonymous quote said, at UCF, we were following George O'Leary, who was a real hard ass. At Nebraska, we were following Mike Riley, who was a nice guy. And so it was like a fire we never put out. I don't think there was an understanding of that, like at the time, in the moment, as it was happening. I think they had so much success at UCF in such a quick amount of time, where it was like, okay, this is what we have to do, and this is how we have to do it, regardless of who the player and what the roster and the personalities might dictate.
Just do it the same. Run the same system, same way. It worked there, it'll work here.
Right. So I think that was the sort of mistake. There was a lack of understanding about sort of the personalities that you had and to get to know those guys and all the things like that. And look at what Matt Rhule has come in and done right away. It's been all the talk has not been about football. It's been about personalities and who people are and getting to know people and understanding that piece of it. And so once you understand that piece of it, you can coach your team more effectively and figure out what they need. I think Matt Rhule is in those stages or finishing those stages right now. And then you get a sense of what how spring ball goes from the football standpoint, and you could devise a plan on what this team is going to be like in the summer and for the season. That was what Scott, that was the step that Scott Frost maybe jumped and didn't have. But you could make the argument, you know, you could make the argument that Scott Frost left Nebraska in a better place. You could make that. I know we've made a lot of jokes about him. But from a player perspective, you've heard Rhule talk about this. I mean, you get a bunch of tough guys in the roster, guys that haven't quit, you know. They were growing some accountability in the back stages of the Scott Frost era, right? Whether it was just something that was said a lot or something that was actually done. And now, so that's actually pointed, you know, they appear to be pointing it in an actual direction, or at least, you know, maybe even a positive direction. God, that light's so bright. I couldn't do it anymore. I was getting a headache. Now that they're pointing it in a positive direction, I don't know. I think the results will probably be pretty good. How many games are they going to win? I have no idea. But are they going to get the most out of their teams? I would think so. And that comes back to a couple of things that, like, it just feels like Rhule is the right guy for this situation. Now, in four years or in 5 years or in 3 years, we might look back and say, I don't know, maybe he wasn't the right guy for that situation. And now looking back on the Frost transition over from Riley, I now think, you know, he just wasn't the right personality and maybe the right guy for that situation. Because you can't. Even with the transfer portal and even with how fast everything moves as far as a roster thing goes nowadays, you still can't flip a college football roster over completely. You're going to have some semblance of what the team was last year. And you have to coach through that. And you have to understand your guys. So it feels like that's one of the things that Matt Rhule sort of understood early. Maybe that's obviously him too. That's how he coaches. So I think it fits him. But it's also something that I think he's sort of come to understand about the players that he has in his locker room. But yeah, there was some interesting stuff in there from a couple different moments of changeover in college football. Good read from Bruce Feldman, of course, in The Athletic. We'll come back. Josh has the top five before we talk Royals with David Lesky in the 1 o'clock hour and Huskers with Michael Bruntz at the bottom of the hour. Plenty more to come on the Connor Happer Show on 1620 The Zone.
Remember, no matter how you listen, it's still AM radio. 1620 The Zone.
It's truck season at Woodhouse Chevy in Missouri Valley with the truck with the strength to take on what's next. The Chevy Silverado. Receive 0% APR for 36 months, plus $1,000 cash allowance and no monthly payments for 90 days on the 2022 Chevy Silverado 1500. Or lease a 2022 Silverado 1500 for $479 a month for 36 months, 10,000 miles per year. Go anywhere this year in a new Chevy and find new roads to Woodhouse Chevy. Exit 75 off I-29 Missouri Valley or WoodhouseGM.com. With approved credit, see dealer for details. Expires 3/31/23.
What was it some famous football coach once said? Attitude isn't just one thing, it's the only thing. Here's an opportunity where your positive attitude can take your career to amazing places. Places like McCarthy's 1 Hour Heating and Air and Benjamin Franklin Plumbing. Along with being a fantastic place to work, the benefits are top shelf and they'll even train the right individual. Click the career tab at McCarthy's1Hour.com. McCarthy's 1 Hour Heating and Air and Benjamin Franklin Plumbing, equal opportunity employer.
The tournament is heating up, and there's no better place to get in on all the action than FanDuel. It is America's number one sports book for a reason, because right now, FanDuel, new customers, listen up. A no-sweat first bet up to $1,000 is coming your way. That's $1,000 back in bonus bets if your first bet doesn't win.
Just go to FanDuel.com/zone and sign up today to claim your no-sweat first bet. Then you can wager on everything from the money line to point spreads to which team will be cutting down the net. All on an app that's safe, secure, and super easy to use. So don't miss your shot at a no-sweat first bet up to $1,000 when you join FanDuel today. Just go to FanDuel.com/zone to sign up. Make every moment more with FanDuel. 21 plus and present in Iowa. First online real money wager only. $10 deposit required. Refund issued and non-withdrawable bonus bets that expire in 14 days. Restrictions apply. See full terms at FanDuel.com/sportsbook. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-BETS-OFF.
Before New Cascade Platinum Plus, I would pre-rinse all my dishes because my old detergent just wouldn't get them clean. But now, I do dishes differently. A no pre-wash, no rewash, money-back guaranteed kind of different. Because Cascade Platinum Plus has double the grease-fighting power of Dawn built right in, with twice the scrubbing power, giving me a clean that lets me break all the dish rules. I just scrape, load, and I'm done. Yep. So clean. With Cascade Platinum Plus, I dare to dish differently.
Breaking news.
Tax refund shock is everywhere, but what is it?
My tax refund shrank.
Mine too.
The culprit? Pandemic-related stimulus payments and tax credits expiring. In this reporter's opinion, you need a tax expert.
Hey guys, Jackson Hewitt guarantees your biggest refund.
And tax prep is 50% off? Going there now.
50% off is a limited-time offer for new clients filing at participating locations. Max value $200. Visit jacksonhewitt.com/50 for terms.
Omaha Maverick baseball and softball seasons are underway. Don't miss a pitch or a run scored. Single game tickets are available now. Come out and support your Mavs. Get your tickets by calling 402-554-MAVS or by going to omavs.com/ticks.
Tell us how you feel on the JTech Construction and Solar Zone Twitter feed. Reach Gary, Nick, Connor, Josh, and John anytime on the JTech Construction and Solar Zone Twitter feed. Contact the official exterior and solar experts of the Huskers. JTech Construction at yourexteriorexperts.com.
Welcome back for the Connor Happer Show on 1620 The Zone and on 1620thezone.com. Josh is the top five today. What's the topic of Josh's top five?
Top five racist moments in WEEI history. No,
what?
No, that wouldn't be very fun, would it?
Why do you hate WEEI?
I hate the city of Boston.
Oh, good take.
As a, even though I'm a Celtics fan, I hate the city of Boston.
Wow, what? Yeah, you need to stop being a Celtics fan.
No, I'm in too deep.
No, you're not.
I'm not.
You hate Boston. You have to love the city that you are a fan of.
Do you?
Yes, I just made that rule up, but
okay.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, it's not a good place. There's not
I love Kansas City. I love Denver.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the homes of my teams.
You love Calgary?
No. I'm an Avs guy.
Oh, that's right.
Avs guy.
Remember when you were a Flames guy for like 2 weeks?
Yeah, I liked the cut of their jib,
mm-hmm.
But I like the Avs better.
Yeah. No, today's top five is top five.
Well, we got to get to the bottom of this.
Would you like to poke some more? We can poke.
I just think you got to.
It's a racist town.
I just think you got to pick a different. You got to pick a different NBA team if that matters to you. How'd you like the Celtics in the first place? You just thought Paul Pierce was cool?
I've told this story before, and our boss was shocked that I said such a thing on the radio, but I will say it again. After Michael Jordan retired, I decided I needed to pick an NBA team, and as a white guy, I thought I had to like the Boston Celtics.
But now you have understood that may have been ill-advised.
That might not have been the case, actually. I was free to like any team in the association that I pleased.
All right, who should Josh be a fan of based on what he values in cities?
Court me, NBA teams, NBA fan bases, please.
Do you like weed, Josh?
I don't.
All right, you can't be a Nuggets fan.
Okay, good, fine. That's fine with me.
That's my own, I mean, you know. That's what Denver's known for now.
It is. That and Coach Prime.
It's true. Ralphie has 8 toes. Okay, what's the stupid top five?
Top five today is top five Succession characters.
Oh, great. This is awesome.
ahead of Sunday's season 4 premiere. I'm just going to throw a blanket spoiler alert over this. I don't know if we're going to spoil anything or not, but I know people are trying to catch up before the new season starts on HBO on Sunday, but I mean, we'll give you fair warning.
This is the best TV show we have right
now. This
is. It'll be ending this year.
It is. Fourth and final season starts on Sunday on HBO. I believe the afternoon show is going to treat this very similarly to Better Call Saul, where they will do
a recap, and they're going to not do it when I'm here.
Yeah, because we could do our own before then.
Like, oh, you could join in the stream if you want to at like 5:45. It's like, no, I'm eating dinner.
Exactly.
Like normal people.
Right.
All right, let's do it.
All right, number 5.
God, come on, take forever.
Jack number Black 5. Coming in hot. Where my Jerry stands at?
Yeah.
I like Jerry.
I like Jerry. I don't know if she'd be in my top 5.
She's smarter than what she's.
She is. I mean, she's definitely got it. She's definitely, you know, looking ahead for the Jerry arc of season 4. Mm-hmm. She's got something up her sleeve.
Yeah, she's plotting something. She ain't no dum-dum.
Yeah. Something's happening there.
Yeah, absolutely.
But at the same time, she's probably going to be done in by her
tawdry love affair.
Yeah. Good one.
Let's put it that way.
Good one.
Number 4.
I was going to say impulsivity.
Mm.
Impulsiveness? Whatever.
Number 4.
She's banging Roman.
Yeah. Number 4. And this surprised even me. Greg.
Greg the egg.
Greg the egg.
Greg the egg, you Machiavellian bleep.
This guy. Connor, I know you didn't watch Game of Thrones, but I'm about to make a Game of Thrones reference.
Greg?
He's the Bran of this whole thing where like, oh, that guy's not going to win in the end. And that guy won in the end.
Oh, yeah. Oh, good one. Because that was the only thing I've come to understand about how Game of Thrones ended. The guy who was just basically an innocent bystander the entire time ended up winning the whole thing.
Yeah.
To a certain extent.
I
could definitely see that with Greg.
I've got a hunch that he might be sitting atop this whole thing at the end.
I mean, the other option, of course, for him is to get thrown away like a piece of trash.
Mm-hmm. Always also possible.
Which could happen at any moment. But he's just he's scratching and clawing, staying mm-hmm. alive. The best on TV relationship that we have right now is between Greg and Tom.
Yes, they are.
That's all we have.
Mm-hmm. What a weird arc that's been.
3. Combination of 3 and 5.
Number 3.
Got to break a couple Tomlins to make a Greg. Or Greg, something like that.
Number 3 is Shiv.
Big Shiv guy.
I think she's the only one of the kids that actually knows what she's doing.
Yeah, she's smart, but she, I don't know. I've started to really hate her.
I don't know if she's good, but she's.
Hey, what's up with the name Shiv? Siobhan? Are people naming their kids Siobhan?
Do you watch things with closed captioning on? Are you at that point in your life yet?
No.
Okay. It's spelled even.
I just turn it up loud.
More. Oh yeah. Because
no, I know it's like Siobhan.
Yeah, you don't have kids, so you watch things at a normal volume.
Is that a name? Is that a thing that people are doing?
I mean, it's a name. Yeah, okay. Absolutely. It's Irish. It's an Irish name.
Problem with Shiv is she can't. I mean, for a lot of different reasons, she has no interest in trusting any of her siblings.
Yeah. And I mean that they've given her no reason to trust.
And unfortunately, her and Tom, which is a great couple, are they're going to have to split.
Yeah. This
that'll have to end.
Yeah. That's coming quick.
If people are at the end of season 3 yet, but there was a moment there that would lead you to believe that that's coming in season 4.
Absolutely.
Here comes
number 2.
This is great. I love talking about Succession. We should do this.
We should. He's not the best character on the show, but man, you can't take your eyes off him. It's Logan.
Bleep off.
Bleep off. He always wins. He's always holding all the cards. He's always 6 steps ahead of you. And he's, you know, he's working on himself.
What do you mean by that?
He's eating that fruit.
Yeah.
I forget which fruit it was.
Yeah.
Was it jackfruit?
Yeah. He's doing all right. Set some health issues, but yeah, yeah. He's working. Yeah. He's working on some things. He's
got that new 20-year-old girlfriend.
Yeah. Brian Cox is, I guess, probably not an American treasure, but a treasure.
Oh, yeah. I mean, he's the voice of your McDonald's commercials. He's Logan Roy.
He's Scottish, so he's just like he is in the show.
Yeah. I read an article with him where he's just like, yeah, this method acting thing is for the birds. I hate method actors. Yeah, and it's like, you're
referring to his co-star.
You're clearly talking about your co-star here and just not giving a bleep. Love that.
Oh, God, this is a big moment.
So who's my number one? Who's my number one? Who's my favorite character?
You had some notable people that you left off here that I love.
Okay, we'll go through it.
Number one.
My guess is that your number one character is Roman. You seem like a Roman guy.
Yeah, he's hilarious. That dude cracks me up.
Good pick. It's a good pick.
He's entertaining as hell.
Belongs in anybody's top five.
Yeah.
For sure.
He's sleazy. He's an awful human being, but man, he gets me through some of those drier episodes of the show.
The insults that are slung at Roman are always the best ones. And by him are always really good too. So yeah, pretty good stuff. Okay. So here's the deal. You left as far as first of all, you left off Kendall. Which, you know, I get it.
I don't like him.
I get it.
I don't like him at all.
You left off Tom, who would be a contender for number one for me.
Right at the end of season three, the last maybe episode or two, I was like, do I like Tom? I thought I always hated Tom. I thought
you
he was
have to love Tom.
I thought he was a super creeper, and now I'm kind of like, oh, maybe I like Tom.
You have to love Tom. Tom deserves to be in anybody's top five. And
Mr. Darcy.
The other one who I would give a sleeper nod to here is Connor.
Well,
he's running for president. he's going to do it his way.
He's just so nothing. Like, I don't think of Connor. Anytime he's not on the show, I am never like, where's Connor?
I know. But he just doesn't live in the same world as anybody.
Nope. He's the eldest son.
But he's really rich and you know that. Yeah, he's the eldest son.
He's getting married.
I would give him a run as a sleeper pick in this one. But a decent list. All right, we're looking forward to having that one come back on Sunday night. Yes, that's right. Prestige TV is back.
It's back all the way back.
Michael tweets in.
Hi, Michael.
How about Rip and Beth from Yellowstone as a couple? Great TV couple. Maybe our second best TV couple right now.
Oh.
Or maybe this is Josh's next top five.
Top five TV couples.
Current active TV couples.
Are there a lot of them? I mean, there's no like Rachel and Ross going right now, is there?
I don't know. Pam and Jim?
Yeah, there's no Pam. Yeah, that's maybe a more modern reference. Thank you.
Not a lot of that. No. But it's up to you to find them, Josh. You're the top five guy, not me.
That's true. This is the lane I've carved out for myself.
Would you take Tom and Greg instead of Tom and Shiv? Greg?
Tom and Greg are a better couple than Tom and Shiv, yes.
Greg, what are you doing here? All right. Thank you, Josh. We'll come back 1 o'clock hour. David Lesky will join. Let's talk some Royals. This one's for me. Next on 1620 The Zone.
Live from the Host Coffee Studio, this is 1620 The Zone.
You can find pizza anywhere, but when you want pizza pie piled high with more toppings, that's when you come to my place, Godfather's Pizza. For a limited time, get your hands on two of my large one-topping pizzas. Pick pepperoni, beef, black olives, you choose. All this food for only $29. Feed your whole mob without breaking the bank. Hey, it's an offer you can't refuse. Godfather's Pizza. Do it.
The Nebraska Lottery has given over $900 million back to our state since 1993. It's gone to improve our environment, education, and state fair.
Over $900 million? That's something.
I'll say.
Hey, I have a great idea for a commercial. Have someone count to 900 million out loud.
That would take 28 years. Not a good idea.
I don't know, with a little background music and some sound effects.
There's another studio down the hall. Why don't you get started?
The Nebraska Lottery. 30 years of building a better Nebraska.
The Nebraska Lottery has given over $900 million back to our state since 1993. The proceeds have helped protect and improve Nebraska's environment, funded need-based scholarships for Nebraska students, and maintained and improved facilities at the state fair.
That's terrific! You should put that on your website.
It already is. Just click on beneficiaries in the menu.
Menu? You guys serve food too?
Maybe you should get off your feet for a while.
The Nebraska Lottery. 30 years of building a better Nebraska.
When you keep a car for a long time, it becomes a classic. When you keep your air conditioner for a long time, it becomes, well, let's just say it doesn't get better with age. Call Standard Heating and Air Conditioning and have your old air conditioner checked out. If it's needed, you can have a brand new Carrier air conditioner installed in no time with fast and easy financing. When the other companies send salesmen, Standard sends qualified technicians. It's just part of
the way we do the things we do.
Carrier, turn to the experts.
Leach Camper Sales and Council Plus get extended sports show deals plus a blowout sale on all select 2022 models, and you don't make a payment for a year. Our new 23s with payments as low as $150 with approved credit. Visit leachcamper.com.
And don't forget, coffee's always on.
Your neighborhood is more than blocks of buildings. It's the people who live there that make it special. At Union Bank and Trust, we're not just creating home loans. We're making neighbors. We're not just small business lenders. We're small business shoppers. We don't just live in your community. We help you build it. Because our people are your people. Visit ubt.com/neighbor to learn more. Union Bank and Trust. Member FDIC.
Nick Handley here for my friends at DJ's Dugout. If you're like me, you love March basketball. DJ's is the place to watch all of the exciting tournament games. DJ's has all the feeds to watch all the big tournament games on huge media walls at the same time. And cheer for Creighton with a Blue Jay lemonade, of course, plus great daily food and drink specials. DJ's Dugout is locally and Vietnam veteran owned. 7 metro locations. Dig in at the dugout.
The Blue Jays are going to the Sweet 16.
Coverage begins Friday at 6 with Robbie Lula. Then join me and Nick Baugh for all the play-by-play starting at 8. The Blue Jays in the Sweet 16, Friday on 1620 The Zone.
Hey everyone, Josh and John here for the FanDuel Sportsbook. March is almost done, but we have many more games to come this weekend. And right now, all customers can get up to $25 back each day if your parlay of 3 legs or more falls just 1 leg short. John, perhaps it's a side that one of our listeners likes. Maybe they're liking an over or an under or a prop bet. Whatever they do, be sure to go to FanDuel.com/1620.
And Josh, upsets have been the name of the day in this tournament. So even if that parlay of 3 legs or more falls just 1 leg short, you can get up to $25 back each day. Just sign into your FanDuel Sportsbook account, or if you don't already have one, FanDuel.com/1620. That's FanDuel.com/1620. 21 plus in present in Iowa. Bonus issued is non-withdrawable bonus bets that expire 7 days after receipt. Max bonus bet $25 per day unless otherwise specified. Restrictions apply. See full terms at FanDuel.com/sportsbook. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-BETS-OFF.
Tickets for less. Best seats, best prices, no per ticket fees. Ticketsforless.com. KOZN Bellevue, Omaha, Council Bluffs. This is 1620 The Zone.
All right, welcome back. We're the Connor Happer Show here on 1620 The Zone, 1620thezone.com here in Omaha. Where you can listen to the Kansas City Royals all summer long, the beautiful sounds of baseball. You can also watch them, maybe, if you have Valley Sports.
Maybe, I don't know.
We're joined now over the phone by David Lesky, writer for Inside the Crown. David, good morning, or afternoon, I guess. How are you?
I'm good. You know, it could be morning. It's morning somewhere.
Yeah, yes.
It all works.
Before we get going here, you have to know I'm a huge Royals fan. We don't usually have like Royals segments on this show, but my producer, Josh, who you have spoken with before, proudly told me this morning, this one's for you talking to me, which is really great. So I appreciate this. So we might get in the weeds on some Royals stuff here.
Let's do it. I'm ready.
First of all, why does it seem, and this is not just this year, as they do, the Royals do lead the Cactus League proudly again. Why are they so good at spring training? It's very confusing to me.
You know, I think it's because they're second best, maybe better than a lot of other teams' second best. Honestly, I don't know the answer. Truly, it's the Royals tend to do pretty well in spring training. I mean, I think they've been under 500 like twice in the last 10 years or three times, something like that. And they've been under 500 a lot more than that in the regular season, as we might all know. It's an interesting question. I don't know the answer. I was actually very curious coming into this season if it was going to be similar, because you know, you wonder maybe they're just not really good at preparing for the season, and they get going and they maybe leave starters in too long. I don't know, whatever it might be. And I thought maybe new manager, maybe the new coaching staff would kind of look a lot more like the rest of the league, where good teams go 8-17 and bad teams go 8, you know, whatever. But no, it's same story as every year. I wish I could tell you. I think if the Royals could tell you, they'd tell you. I don't think they know either. One of those things, I guess.
What have been the noticeable? You mentioned the new coaching staff, and there's been a lot. What are a couple of the most noticeable differences you've seen thus far? It's tough to tell because it's spring training, but you could sometimes get a sense and approach and stuff like that. And then after a while development, what are a couple of the things that you've noticed that are different with this coaching staff compared to the last?
Yeah, well, a couple of things. And one of them kind of tends back to last season because it's the new hitting approach. So they're not new, but they're new in the last couple of years to the organization. The Zoom wall, I mean, Zoom wall's been there for a while, but the whole approach they put into place throughout, they do a really nice job of picking their zone basically as hitters. And they say, look, until we get to two strikes, I'm not swinging at a pitch unless it's here and wherever here is for each individual hitter. I have noticed in the handful of times we've been able to watch them this spring that it's a pretty consistent trend among all the hitters. They're not chasing until two strikes. And then there are some issues with two strikes. I'm sure we'll see young hitters, all that. But
wait, so you mean they're actually going to walk?
They might. Look, MJ Melendez and Vinny Pasquantino both walk. So those guys are going to be toward the top of the order somewhere. I think that they will probably continue. Kyle Isbell, you know, say what you want. His plate discipline up until last season was never an issue. Last year, things got weird. I think he started striking out looking on borderline pitches early in the season. Mm. And I think it just completely torpedoed him. You know, they have some guys who will take some pitches. They have Salvador Perez too. So
right.
it's going to be totally different. But I do really like the approach that we've seen from the hitters. And then on the pitching side, you know, this goes back to the start of spring and really before that when they talked about a different way for the catching to set up. They're setting up closer to the plate and down the middle. And I think the last few days have been a little bit rough, but I think what we've seen is they're throwing more strikes. They really are. And it's a different approach than we've seen before, but it's what the Rays do. And if you can do something like what the Rays do, you pretty much do it. Because they're good and they're always good. And Quintero and Paul Hoover, they brought that approach over. It's funny. The Baseball America had an article about that like 2 days before spring training started. Maybe I can't remember exactly the timeline. And I'm going, well, the Royals have raised guys. Why can't they do that? And then all of a sudden, Aaron Rodgers from MLB.com writes a story about it. I'm going, oh, they are doing it. Okay, great. Perfect.
Yeah.
and that's kind of those are the two biggest differences I've seen. I think we're going to see more strikes thrown and fewer balls swung at by the hitters, I guess. That's a weird way to put it. But I think that's kind of the gist of it.
What do you think the importance is or was of making the change of the timing that they did it, given that this young crop of guys, obviously led by Bobby Witt Jr., is coming up now. Most of them experienced almost a full season in the major leagues last year, but doing it now before, you know, it gets too ingrained in who they are and what they are. I just feel like it was pretty good timing to have that happen and to have a new way of coaching or approach come into town.
Yeah. I mean, I think it could have been earlier, honestly, but yeah. You can't change the past, obviously. So, I think to be honest, I think a lot of it's more about the pitching. The position players, just because, you know, Matt Quatrero, he comes from the Rays and, you know, bench coach, and did a lot of stuff with the strategy and stuff like that. So there's some pitching there. But if you look up and down these, and I say young, they're 26, 27 years old, a lot of them, but the inexperienced pitchers, they're in their third year. I mean, Brady Singer's in his fourth year, and he's not the problem, so fine. But, I mean, Chris Bubich is in his fourth year. Daniel Lynch is in his third year. Jonathan Heasley's been up a couple times, and he's struggled quite a bit this spring. But they are on borrowed time. These guys, some of them are going to be out of options in 2024. Yep. So they're going to either have to stick or go to the minors. There are just a lot of questions with these pitchers, and the Royals couldn't waste another year with Cal Eldred leading them. And then they just couldn't do it. I think back to when they fired Terry Bradshaw back in May last season, and everything we heard and was confirmed that Peyton Moore didn't want to do it. Peyton Moore had to be convinced by J.J. Piccolo to let Terry Bradshaw go and bring up the hitting instructors we just talked about and all that. I wonder if there was some power struggle over Cal Eldred if J.J. Piccolo didn't want to make that move a lot earlier.
Oh, for sure.
I'm sure he did, yeah. But they kind of had to do it. And I was told by somebody who I very much trust on this, back in, I think it was December, that getting Matheny and Eldred out of the dugout, doesn't matter who they hire, is worth 10 wins. and it's funny because I heard that and I was like, oh, that's an exaggeration, but okay. And then you start to like hear more and more. And I think I tweeted this the other day, but when you listen to Royals pitchers, they do the in-game broadcast during spring training, right? And you listen to them and they just sound happy and excited and like yearning for knowledge. And we never heard that. Chris Bubich is the only real example of that because he does it on his own. And that's a reason why I will believe in him until he retires, probably.
Yeah.
he can retire with a 12.3 ERA. And I'm going, he might turn it around because he's smart. But you really heard a difference and you hear it every time they talk. I mean, Brad Keller talking about going to Driveline and learning about things he'd never heard before. Mm-hmm. Like that's ridiculous. And so then you start to wonder, maybe 10 wins is not enough. I don't know. But it was a really interesting comment and I don't think I'll ever forget it.
The common sentiment that we heard was like they have all these talented pitchers, which they drafted most of them in the first round and you know, or around there. There's no reason why they're not good. There's no reason why they're not better than they are. So I don't know. The dots sort of start to connect from there.
Well, it goes, think about that Athletic article from last year.
Yep.
If you remember that one.
Yep.
And the other thing that I can't get out of my head, I can like see it when I close my eyes, is the quote from the scout who goes, if these guys were on the Guardians or Brewers or Rays, they'd be studs. And that quote, and look, it's one opinion. And there could be 50 others who disagree with that. But that one opinion says they drafted the right guy. They developed him wrong. And, you know, the Royals have not been shy about saying the issue with development has been at the big league level. And I don't completely agree with that. I think that there's been some issues in the minors. Now, where I could be wrong is if Cal Eldred at the big league level was dictating the methodology. Mm-hmm. So that could be, it could be that he was, you got to cut the snake's head off and then everything's fine. But I think there's some other issues in the minors. I mean, they had a really bad year throughout the minors last season. I mean, all the way from rookie ball up to Omaha. And So I'm interested to see how that changes, but I don't know. I think that the Royals are putting all their eggs in that basket, and I'm interested to see if they were right.
Who stands the most to gain out of these four? Lynch, Keller, Bubich, Kowar.
That's a good question. Immediately it's Keller because he's going to be a free agent after the season. So yeah. Individually and immediately, Brad Keller, if he can put together a good season, he's going to go out and get, I don't know, 8 figures. Yeah. 60 million, maybe. You can see it. I can see 4 years and 60 million if he has a good season. So he benefits from that. Career wise, it's hard to say because I think any one of them can be really good at the big league level if they can fix some pitch shape, fix some of their pitch mix, fix their command. It's a lot of stuff to fix, yes. But I would say probably Daniel Lynch of those three, just because I think Chris Bubich has the lowest ceiling. Jackson Kowar, I don't know if he's going to be a starter, but Daniel Lynch, I could still see him starting game one of a playoff series.
Yeah.
I could still see that happening. And so I think he's the guy, but really any of them.
David Lesky is with us here talking some, just nerding out on the Royals for a little bit. Big picture. What do you think is a realistic timeline here for whether it's getting to the play? When you throw out, they could potentially get 10 wins better just by changing over the coaching staff. You're already bumping up against, sort of contending right away. Do you believe that that's a possibility this year, or how close are the Royals to getting back into that conversation?
I think it's possible this season. The issue is there's, any given season, every team has to have certain things go right to get there. And the goal of the offseason is to make the number of things that have to go right, make them less and less, because it's hard for everything to go one way. So I think they have too much that they have to get, that has to get right. They need to, their starting rotation has to probably stay really healthy, which is doable. But they also have to be good because they don't have a lot of depth in the rotation. I think that you need to see multiple young guys on offense take steps forward. And that includes Melendez and Witt and guys we're counting on as fans to be really good.
Yeah.
They haven't been really good yet.
Yeah.
And that's okay. It was their first season. I'm not saying that it's a disappointment, but they've got to get better. There's just a lot that has to happen. So is it possible? Absolutely. They've got talent. It's not like this is the 2006 Royals or something. It's an actually talented roster. They're green. And so I don't see it happening this year. There's really no reason to look at this roster and say they can't be good in 2024, especially given the division. They should be able to be better. And I think the big thing in 2023, as long as they properly evaluate the talent they have, that will allow them to spend next offseason filling the holes that they've discovered they have. And everything I've heard is, hey, they're going to spend if the right part is there, they're not going to go with the cheap veteran over the good young player. Everything points to if they know where they need a target and that's available, they're going to go after it in free agency and in a trade too. So I wouldn't be surprised if they make the playoffs in 2024. If you were asking me for a dead on prediction, I'd probably say 25 just because I'd hedge my bets, but there's no reason they can't compete next season.
One more for you before we let you get out of here. How important do you think World Baseball Classic experience for Royals had, whether it was Melendez and Vinny and Nicky Lopez and, of course, Bobby Witt Jr., they're all in World Baseball Classics, some of them with extended runs, obviously, to varying degrees of whether they were in the lineup or not. How important do you think that is? We're just talking about building a potential playoff contender. This is the core of those guys. I feel like that piece kind of can't be understated. I feel like it's important.
Yeah, I think being around, for Bobby Witt Jr., for example, being around Mike Trout, Mookie Betts, and Trey Turner, who is, I don't hear him comp to Trey Turner very often, but that's kind of perfect.
Yeah, I agree.
Beady shortstops, they don't walk a lot. It's they they're similar type players. Being around those guys, I don't think hurts at all. The one issue that I have is Brady Singer. I first of all, the U.S. pitching staff wasn't good enough for him to get a lot of benefit, I don't think. Yeah. I feel like that was rough. And then he goes and throws two innings.
That was tough.
He's thrown 53 pitches since March 6th. he's going out there in like an hour and a half, and he's going to be on a 45 pitch count 6 days from opening day because he's just not built up. And that, you know, I don't know what he took from that. I hope the atmosphere fueled him a little bit, I guess. And maybe he picked Adam Wainwright's brain quite a bit. I don't know. That's the one that I look at. And I'm like, I don't think that was worth it. We only had three plate appearances, but he can go to the backfield and hit. I mean, they do things all the time where they get guys who lead off every inning. So he can get 9 plate appearances in the minor league. And so he'll be fine. Pitchers take as long as they take to get up to speed. And that's where I'm concerned.
Yeah. David Lesky inside the crown. Great stuff, David. Appreciate it. Thanks for letting me nerd out for a little while. We'll do this a couple more times this year.
Sounds good. Thanks so much.
That is David Lesky. Thank you, Josh.
Happy to do it, my friend.
Thank you, Josh. You're the best.
1 week from opening day.
I was going to ask him about the 26 roster spot, but I felt like that was pushing my luck. Thanks, Josh.
Happy to do it.
Got an email during that from John.
Hi, John.
Subject line, Royals.
Uh-oh.
Why would anyone expect the Royals to have any success if they were letting Terry Bradshaw make decisions? He isn't even good at being an NFL analyst. How could he be good at Major League Baseball? Now, the Royals had a hitting coach last year named Terry Bradshaw. If you look up that person, they look different. I'll just say that. They're not the same guy.
Okay.
Did you freak out a little bit when you said that, when he said that was worth 10 wins? Just anybody else?
I felt it come off of me. Like, ooh.
What's the Royals win total right now?
Look at you talking yourself into
just
this.
What is it? I just want to know.
What is it?
I just want to know. Baseball.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. When are we going to do our win total show?
Well, we got a week, I guess.
Yeah.
I don't see the win totals.
Oh no.
On our friends with the FanDuel Sportsbook.
Maybe they're quickly editing it because they heard that the Royals are going to get 10 more now.
I would. I would do that if I were them.
Mm-hmm.
AL. I imagine they have the worst odds to win the AL Central. Yeah, plus 3,500. Worse than the Tigers.
Not FanDuel, but another inferior sports book has it at 68.5. Same as the Tigers.
Over.
Same as the Tigers.
I have to think about that. I start thinking once you give me like a 73.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm over.
Oh, Braves have the same amount as the Dodgers, 96.5.
That's a lot of wins, Josh.
That's a lot of wins.
People forget that.
Houston 97.5.
Oh, look at Texter John.
Hi, John.
He wants more of the crown. He wants wants more Royals talk.
Well, I mean, if the people demand it.
We can have a Royals chat. By the way, while we're talking to David there, Sam Hybe for the Nebraska women's team announced that she suffered an injury in Nebraska's previous NIT game against Northern Iowa, which will keep her out for the remainder of that stretch. So her career is now over.
Mm, sad way to end.
It is. I mean, truly a really great person who had suffered through injuries this year and had the roller coaster of, oh my God, she's back after she thought she tore ACL and was out for the season.
Mm-hmm.
And then came back and ended up, it took her a while, I think, get back and ended up being really productive. I think in her last full game, in that last NIT game at home against Missouri State, I mean, she really looked like old Sam. She was driving to the hoop, you know, with some ease, blowing by people. She had 25 points in that game. So that's a decent way to go out. Didn't get a win at Kansas tonight, but tough way to end it for Sam Hybe. We'll come back with Michael Bruntz. We'll get his takes on the A's and some football.
Ace chat.
And we'll do that next year on 1620 The Zone.
Mornings with Sharp and Hanley.
Now it gets me thinking, what else in life should have a pitch clock? Like when you have to check in and with your wife on a phone call, shouldn't that have a pitch clock?
Yeah.
Like getting your kids ready to go to school in the morning.
Oh my gosh, yep.
Shouldn't that have a pitch clock?
Sorry, kid, pitch clock. All right.
What about like another thing in life that needs a pitch clock? You know when you're at with your friends and you're at a bar and a story will start? And it just goes on and on.
Just
and
play
on. Shouldn't that have a pitch clock as well?
Mornings with Sharp and Hanley, weekdays 6 to 10 on 1620 The Zone. Your Omaha area forecast from the Godfather's Pizza Weather Center and KETV News Watch 7 on 1620 The Zone.
Mostly cloudy and cool for your Thursday afternoon with highs today into the mid-40s, including for the Omaha Metro. Expect northerly winds up to 10 miles an hour, keeping us cool. Tonight, partly to mostly cloudy skies, staying chilly with a low near 30 degrees. I'm meteorologist Caitlin Harvey with KETV News Watch 7.
The Connor Happer Show returns in minutes on 1620 The Zone.
Hey everyone, Josh Peterson here for my friends at Miracle Hill Golf and Tennis. I have been saying it throughout the last few weeks. They are changing the way that they do golf instruction at Miracle Hill Golf and Tennis. One of the changes, on-course instruction. If you want to find out more information and learn from Mike Faber and Jonathan Melke, find your best golf swing. Give them a call today at 402-498-0220. They're located just north of Dodge on 120th Street. Miracle Hill Golf and Tennis. Hey everyone, Josh Peterson here for my friends at Kugler Vision. It is spring break season. How about you take a break from those glasses and contacts? Give them a call today at 402-558-2211 or schedule a consultation online at kuglervision.com.
Guys, let's face it. There is a time when you just need to get out of the house, to have your own place, to be with the guys, or just a quiet, relaxing place for yourself. Well, Hearth Cigars and Pipes Lounge hears you loud and clear. Settle in. Escape to Hearth Cigars and Pipes Lounge for an incredible selection, plus premium cocktails, a knowledgeable, friendly staff, state-of-the-art humidor, and incredible lounge. Hearth Cigars and Pipes Lounge, just off I-680 at 48th Street next to Covey's.
What do you mean he went searching for fresher powder? We have full classes today.
Instructor down at Vesper Ski School.
We toured each other to snowplow, honey. Not a way.
She needs more ski instructors to slalom through the day-to-day.
Pizza? Fries? Whoa, Braley, no. Pizza, pizza.
Indeed can help her hire great people fast.
I need Indeed.
Indeed you do. We instantly connect you with quality candidates whose resumes on Indeed match your job description. Visit Indeed.com/credit and get $75 towards your first sponsored job. Terms and conditions apply.
Homeowners have trusted Malarkey Shingles for years for beauty and long life. They've also trusted a local certified Malarkey Shingle residential contractor for years. Karps Complete Home Exteriors. It's your roof. For the best, it's Karps.
Ray Magliotta here for eBay Motors. Okay, easy now. You're teaching your kid how to parallel park. Ouch! Turns out he likes to do it by feel. Don't worry, eBay Motors has bumpers, trunk lids, license plate holders, and headlights. They've got lots of headlights. When you need parts, get it right the first time with eBay Guaranteed Fit. When you see the check, you know that part's going to fit. eBay Motors, let's ride. Eligible items only. Exclusions apply.
Tired of having a website that doesn't reflect the quality of your brand? At JM Online, we specialize in custom websites for unique business needs. Your website should be more than just a digital billboard. It should be a powerful tool that grows your business. Awarded Omaha's Best Web Developers in 2023, we're dedicated to local business success. So if you're ready to take your website to the next level, go to jmonline.com and request a call.
At Baker's, we want our fresh produce to meet your expectations, which is why we're dedicated to doing up to a 27-point inspection on our fruits and veggies, checking for things like scarring. In fact, only the best produce, like zesty oranges and crisp carrots, reach our shelves. Because when it comes to fresh, our higher standards mean fresher produce. Baker's, fresh for everyone.
Don't miss this fresh deal on ground beef. Right now, 73% lean Kroger ground beef sold in a 5-pound package is just $3 a pound with your card. Baker's, fresh for everyone.
Equitable Bank. We take banking personally. EquitableOnline.com.
Broncos country. Let's ride.
Breaking news.
Michael Bruntz.
is the second time that breaking news has happened right when I come on the show. That's a good life lesson to be learned in all this. If you're going to give somebody over $100 million, make sure they're not weird.
Michael Bruntz, Husker 24-7. I'm
that dog. All right, we welcome in Michael Bruntz of Husker 24-7. Bruntz, you have to know I'm at an elevated state of excitement right now because I just had a Royals guest on for the last 20 minutes.
Yeah.
He basically, it was David Lesky.
Okay.
So, you know, I was already going to bet the Royals over. Now I'm really going to bet the Royals over.
What's the number for your boys in blue?
68.5.
Oh, yeah. Hammer the over.
Do you know what the number is for your boys in green?
Is it over 60?
It is not.
I didn't think so.
It may be the lowest win total I've ever seen. 59.5.
Man.
That is, so you're betting on either 100 or, you know, or 101 or 102 losses.
Yeah, no, it's going to be bad. I'm not going to like it. And it's funny because the A's are kind of courting Las Vegas right now. And apparently the way that they're going to do that is by buying way, 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 way low.
I saw I think the Royals played a game at the Vegas ballpark this past week. Is that where they're going to move into?
No, they don't have a site yet.
They're going to build them a new stadium?
Everybody in Vegas is the prevailing feeling I get reading a lot from the people in Vegas is they don't want the A's and they think they would rather have an actual expansion franchise instead of a garage sale franchise like the A's would be.
Oh, that hurts.
Yeah.
That hurts. Okay.
When Vegas is like, this is a little too much for us, that tells you something, right?
Only a week until opening day.
Yeah.
Pretty exciting.
Yeah.
So you got the chance to take in some practice this morning. How was the practice?
It was awesome. It was spirited. They're moving around well.
Oh.
And it was, you don't learn a ton. I mean, it was a lot of individual stuff. But it was fast paced. It was extremely organized. And I mean, there's so many new guys on the team too,
yeah,
that it was, you're kind of like, oh, that's who that guy is that, you know, we've been writing about and talking about for the last 6 months. And there he is.
Did you see Jeff Sims throw a football by chance?
I saw him throw one football. I was going back through when I was doing my practice observations and I realized that I saw Richard Torres throw a couple times and they were both like 5 yard throws. And it was during a drill where Marcus Satterfield is just banging on him with a pad, to kind of simulate ball control. So, it was pretty limited with footballs in the air. It's a lot of teaching and technique work for everybody else.
The only videos I saw of Sims were of him like just dropping back and not throwing a football. Like I don't know.
The quarterbacks are doing a lot with handoffs and play action rollouts. So and because the wide receivers and tight ends were off kind of doing their own thing, that they were thrown to like a GA or something like that.
Do you think the naked boot's going to be back?
Yeah, it's going to be nude. There's going to be some naked bootlegs based on what I say. And that was part of South Carolina's offense last year too. If you go back and watch it, they did a lot of that stuff.
Bruntz, on a semi-serious note, I guess, when do you think we'll hear from Jeff Sims or any of the, I mean, I guess we've weirdly heard from Heinrich Harburg. But the interviews have sort of been all over the board, and you know, for a variety of different reasons. Like, do you think we'll hear from Jeff Sims over the next couple of weeks?
Yeah, I would think so. You know, it's interesting that the Harburg thing was interesting to me because I was like, okay, you know, we're getting Heinrich Harburg right out of the gates here, and everybody's like, okay, what does this mean?
I chalked that up to like he was a really good weight room guy.
Yeah, I mean, that's basically what it was.
Yeah.
It was either, you know, something's going on here, or he wants some obscure summer or winter workout competition, and that's why we're getting it. But no, I mean, they like him leadership-wise, you know, and that was kind of why he was there. It was just kind of a mix of players that they rolled out there with. You know, Matt Rhule, I think, has some weight on who goes up there, by the way. So I think that's noteworthy too.
Did any of the transfers pop off the page to you, just in terms of what they look like physically?
Oh, I mean, Eric Gilbert. You know, you don't. I have not seen many tight ends that size at Nebraska and moving that well.
Didn't Rhule say he weighed like 290 pounds or something like that?
He said in the 270s, okay, somewhere around there. I mean, when he was at Georgia, I was talking to some of our guys down there that are pretty plugged in with that program. And last spring, Gilbert was right around, I think, 260. And they were like, you know, you couldn't tell him apart from some of the wide receivers down there. Like, that's how well he was moving. So, I mean, that's the potential he has. He was actually working, like, in the blocking units on special teams today, which I thought that was pretty good to see. Because that tight end room as a whole after today, I was kind of like, okay, I was concerned about it. But, I mean, you've got Gilbert, you know, you got to make sure that everything's, you know, going well there for him. But, you know, Fedoni, coming off a knee injury, there's some question marks about some of these guys. But you're like, man, that's the potential in that room. It's kind of interesting. And then, you know, AJ Rollins looks the part. I was pretty impressed with how he looked. And then you add, you know, Janarian Bonner and Jake Apple get to that group too. I mean, they've got some options there that I guess maybe I kind of overlooked or, you know, really hadn't considered, you know, when we were kind of doing the pecking order of biggest concerns in the offseason.
Did you do the classic scribbling down of the first offensive line group you saw?
I made note of it. it's always, I mean, you're basically wanting to know where Turner Corcoran is, right? I mean, that's kind of what you're really looking for.
Well, I think you like Scott is the predicted, you know, the projected center. Nwili is a guard somewhere. And then the rest of it sort of depends on either injury or what you do with Corcoran.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, that's, and you know, you've got Teddy Prohaska taking some reps, you know, in a green jersey. I mean, that's there as well. But, you know, I know Donovan Raiola, you know, when he talked to the media over the winter, said, yeah, you know, we're looking at, you know, Ben Scott, maybe at a couple places. I mean, he's your center. I mean, he looked like a center today. He was in control like you want a center to be. And I mean, there's no question that's who's going to start there in my mind. But I don't know. It's an intriguing group. You know, especially when you add Nwili back to that mix guard. And if you can kind of move Corcoran around too. I mean, that's where I think you might start getting a little bit of an interesting crew there.
Brunson.
I thought Bryce Benhart looked a little bit, slimmed down too from what he had been, which I think is a good thing.
Ooh. Yeah, probably is. Bruntz, I know that there were some recruits already sort of leaking in for the weekend today. I mean, you're getting closer and closer. I don't know that you'll ever nail down a list, but taking a look at who you might have coming in this weekend, put it in context with some of the other, you know, big major recruiting weekends that we've seen, especially in the spring. And this feels like as significant as it gets.
Yeah, I mean, well, 24/7 Sports just redid their rankings this week, and I think Nebraska is going to have three of the top 10 guys on that list on campus this week.
God.
That's not happened, you know, in the last decade. And that's just, you know, that's just, you know, three guys. I mean, you've got a number of four-star guys, top 100 type prospects. It really is impressive the work that they've done in kind of setting this up. It'll be interesting to see how you kind of manage all that, because I mean, it's a great list, but you also have, you know, a heck of a lot of talent coming through your doors, and you got to make sure that you knock that out of the park, which I'm sure they're going to do. But yeah, I mean, I even the Calabrasca stuff, and you know, when you had Micah Parsons and you know, some of those highly ranked guys coming through. I mean, you just never had this kind of star power before. I want to say there was a season opener back when, you know, when Riley was there, that, you know, they had some pretty impressive guys there, but nothing like this, and certainly not in the spring. So they've got a chance to do some real work here. We'll see what they can do with it, though.
How does baseball pick up the pieces after the Tuesday night fiasco?
Yeah, win Friday. I mean, it's tough because, I mean, you get like just a complete out of your mind pitching performance from Will Walsh, and you just can't get it over the finish line. And I think, you know, from Will's perspective, you know, I think they didn't really feel great about what they had in the bullpen out there behind Walsh.
Yeah, clearly.
And they wanted him to finish it out. So it's just a tough spot. I mean, I think, you know, going into conference play, I think Nebraska's got probably one of the better 1-2 starting punches in the league in Olsen and Kaminska. But, you know, with the issues they've had finding a Sunday starter, with some of the bullpen issues they've had, especially as they've gotten later into series, I mean, it's Sundays could get pretty darn interesting just based on where they're at right now. So they just got to figure out guys that can throw strikes and you know, kind of start to put them in some roles, because I think you're kind of getting, you know, hurt two ways. You don't have guys that can do it right now, and those guys, in order to do it, kind of need to know what role they're going to be in. So it's just a tough spot to be in.
How many bullpen pieces do you think they, you know, trust right now? Is it just Shaneman and end of list?
Yeah, I mean, I think they would probably feel good about Perry in small doses. I mean, I think they like what Garza can do. He's just been so inconsistent, and you know, they tried to have him start on Sundays. I think he'll probably still get another shot at that, but you know, somebody, it feels like somebody has to emerge from that group of Clark, Brockett, Garza, to give you a little bit more depth there. I've been surprised that we haven't seen a little bit more Mason Ornelas or Will Rizzo, the transfer from A&M. I mean, maybe they give them a shot in one of those midweeks, but they've got to find somebody, because it's just, you can't rely on Olsen and Kaminska to go, you know, super deep into games every possible start that they have.
How excited are you for the Shane Comanay, and then I guess Alex Gordon and Darren Erstad retirement tomorrow, but mostly Shane Comanay?
It'll be good to see him back. He's been back a few times in the recent years. I was thinking about it the other day, because they had the bobblehead night.
Yep,
he came back for that.
That was probably what, 3-4 years ago.
Yeah, he got inducted into the Nebraska Athletics Hall of Fame. He was back for that. So he's been around the program a little bit. So, I mean, that's good. I mean, he's, you know, obviously still in Hawaii, but getting him back is pretty cool. And, you know, Darren hasn't been around a ton,
no,
I don't think, since he stepped away. So it'll be good to see him out there too. But, yeah, I'm glad they finally did it. It's my understanding that it's actually pretty difficult to retire a number, because you have to form committees and you have to talk about it. And, you know, these three guys seem like pretty big no-brainers to me. Yeah,
absolute no-brainers. Weird on the committee thing. Everything takes a committee.
You always need a committee, man.
You just gotta
have it.
All right. Bruntz, enjoy that tomorrow. Have a good weekend. We'll talk to you later.
Sounds good. Thanks.
Michael Bruntz of Husker 24/7. Ah, committees. You need a committee to retire those three numbers. Get the hell out of here.
That feels like unnecessary bureaucracy. It's
incredibly unnecessary. Yeah. Poll question at Happer Show. Do you always need a committee? He's up and available for your voting, but they'll kind of close in just a couple minutes here, as we'll get to the poll questions and tell you what to watch. There's basketball tonight. People forget. Next on 1620 The Zone. And speaking of this March, protect yourself against upsets with bracket parlay insurance on FanDuel Sportsbook. Right now, all customers can get up to $25 back each day if your parlay of three legs or more falls one leg short. So let's say you bet on all four games tonight. You like what you see. You feel like you got a beat, and Gonzaga screws you over, or UCLA screws you over, or anybody. Well, Bracket Parlay Insurance is going to help you out. Can't think of how many times that's happened to me. And you need to get on the action with the FanDuel Sportsbook. And also with Cash Out, you're calling the shots. You can close out your bet whenever you want before the game is over. Just sign into your FanDuel Sportsbook account or go to FanDuel.com/Happer to sign up today. That's FanDuel.com/Happer. Make every moment more with FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook. 21 and over, present in Iowa. Bonus issued is now withdrawable bonus bets that expire 7 days after receipt. Max bonus bet, $25, unless otherwise specified. Restrictions apply. See full terms at FanDuel.com/sportsbook. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-BETS-OFF.
The best way to catch all the action is on 1620 The Zone. And no line for the bathroom.
You can find pizza anywhere. But when you want pizza pie piled high with more toppings, that's when you come to my place, Godfather's Pizza. For a limited time, get your hands on two of my large one-topping pizzas. Thick pepperoni, beef, black olives, you choose. All this food for only $29. Feed your whole mob without breaking the bank. Hey, it's an offer you can't refuse. Godfather's Pizza. Do it.
Do you like to shoot fireworks? Would you like to get paid to shoot fireworks? J&M Displays wants you. Help shoot an Omaha Storm Chasers game, Memorial Park display, or any of the major shows in Western Iowa and all of Nebraska. If you like to travel, J&M covers Nebraska, Kansas, and most of Missouri. They offer free training and great daily pay rates, which makes it a perfect part-time job. Visit jnmdisplays.com and click the Join Our Team tab to find out more. J&M Fireworks.
What do you mean he went searching for fresher powder? We have full classes today.
Instructor down at Vesper Ski School.
Support each other to snowplow, honey, not a way.
She needs more ski instructors to slalom through the day-to-day.
Pizza? Fries? Whoa, Braley, no! Pizza, pizza!
Indeed can help her hire great people fast.
I need Indeed.
Indeed you do. We instantly connect you with quality candidates whose resumes on Indeed match your job description. Visit Indeed.com/credit and get $75 towards your first sponsored job. Terms and conditions apply.
Standard Heating and Air Conditioning is and has always been locally owned and operated. Now, with 160 employee owners, chances are one of us lives in your neighborhood. We take pride in taking care of you, our customers, and keeping you comfortable all year round. And as always, our technicians don't have sales quotas. When other companies send salespeople, Standard sends qualified technicians. It's just part of
Carrier, turn to the experts.
Ever walk through a door and see all the trucks? Yeah. It's kind of like that at Gretna Auto Outlet. Half-ton trucks, three-quarter-ton trucks, dualies, gas or diesel. Gretna Auto Outlet will be happy to show it to you. They don't call it truck heaven for nothing, you know. Stop in the climate-controlled comfort of the indoor showroom or online with the virtual showroom at GretnaAuto.com. Gretna Auto Outlet, open Sundays too, just north of Nebraska Crossing on Highway 6 in Gretna.
Nick Handley here for my friends at DJ's Dugout. If you're like me, you love March basketball. DJ's is the place to watch all of the exciting tournament games. DJ's has all the feeds to watch all the big tournament games on huge media walls at the same time. And cheer for Creighton with a Blue Jay lemonade, of course, plus great daily food and drink specials. DJ's Dugout is locally and Vietnam veteran-owned. 7 metro locations. Dig in at the dugout.
PACE, Police Athletics for Community Engagement Organization, is dedicated to preventing at-risk and disadvantaged inner-city children from becoming involved in street gangs, crime, drug use, and victimization. Last year, PACE served over 5,000 area kids with wholesome competition and free participation in soccer, baseball, CrossFit, and flag football. To help PACE and local families make sure kids have access to safe and fun spring and summer activities, please go to PACEOmaha.org to support the PACE mission. Thank you.
Josh will cover this on What to Watch tonight, but 4 basketball games this evening starting at 5:30. That's why there is an abbreviated unsportsmanlike conduct this afternoon. Only slightly, though. And that's why they kicked me out for the crossover.
They said we
bunch of jerks.
They said that your shenanigans will not be needed.
That's what I do, huh? Yeah.
Wow.
I'm the shenanigans guy now.
Apparently.
Michigan State and K-State starts at 5:30 this evening. Arkansas, UConn, Florida Atlantic, Tennessee, Gonzaga, UCLA. Josh will tell you how to watch those in a moment. Poll questions at Happer Show. You ever think about working in government?
No.
Yes. Doesn't seem like they do a lot. 58% say no.
Really?
Never even thought about it, huh?
Hmm.
Do you miss letters to the grandstand? Even though Amazing Daniel jumped in and said it was voices from the grandstand.
It's true.
Why? I don't know why it would be letters to the grandstand, Josh. Yeah, that doesn't make any sense at all. But I do miss the general idea. 56% agree. And then just two more polls. Wow, light poll day.
Yeah.
Do you think the naked boot's going to be back? As I asked to Michael Bruntz, yes, 85% of the vote. And finally, do you always need a committee? Early returns. I mean, you do. You don't, but
no.
That's what society tells us. So yes is the answer. 68% say no. You don't always need a committee.
Mm.
Those are the poll questions. Josh, what are we watching tonight?
As you said, four Sweet 16 games tonight. We'll have
those give me right your picks. Here. You got to give me your picks.
Oh, okay. Michigan State versus K-State, 5:30, TBS.
Wildcats plus one.
Give me the Wildcats.
And let's just do straight up. Wildcats.
Arkansas, UConn, 6:15 on CBS. Give me UConn.
Dan Hurley.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Who I love so dearly.
Desperately. Yes. 8 o'clock TBS FAU.
I actually do love Dan Hurley compared to the Must Bus.
Really? Wow. FAU versus Tennessee, 8 o'clock TBS. Give me the high octane Owls.
God damn it. Yeah, I was going to hoot on that one too.
Oh, okay. Gonzaga, UCLA, your
nightcap. I just don't think you should be able to win basketball games when you score 52 points.
I agree with that.
It's illegal.
Wholeheartedly. 8:45 CBS, Gonzaga, UCLA. Give me the Bruins.
Same here. All right. That was stupid.
Nah, we agreed. Fun stuff there.
I got UCLA winning the national championship. So, and I know, yes, they have an injury to Jalen Clark. I remember. I still picked them. And they're still in the tournament.
WNIT tonight. Five games, including Nebraska at Kansas, 6:30 start for the Huskers. ESPN Plus, you said, Connor? Okay.
That's what they're telling me.
Okay, good. You would know. Doubleheader on NBA TV tonight. Knicks Magic at 6 o'clock. Thunder Clippers at 9:30. And finally, in the NHL tonight, ESPN doubleheader. Wild Flyers at 5:30. 8 o'clock puck drop between the Penguins, the other Pennsylvania team, and the Stars in Texas.
Not the Lincoln Stars?
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
Got it.
Didn't want any confusion there.
Stars! That's it?
That's what we're watching tonight.
That is indeed what we are watching, but mostly basketball.
Yeah.
And probably not hockey. And we have all the same picks for the basketball game, so fade us. That would be my advice to you all.
Yes.
And then tomorrow, we'll do it all again. It's just not the same on the second weekend.
The vibe is significantly different.
The vibe is different. All right, that's it for us today. If you miss anything, 1620thezone.com is where you can find it. Rudely kicked out of the crossover, So that's not coming next. But on Sportsmanlike Conduct with John Bishop, live from Churchill Downs.
The real Churchill Downs?
I don't know I don't know if that's real, but he tweeted it, so I'm gonna promote it like it is.
It's just 4 miles.
He's gonna
from the
do
arena.
The show with a horse.
Wow.
Next on 1620 The Zone.
Live from the Host Coffee Studio. This is 1620.